7:30, we have the agenda.
I move to adopt. Second.
Any changes?
No comments.
Comments? Public?
No. To the agenda or?
To the agenda.
Not to the agenda.
We're good to go. Call for a vote. Shall we? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The consent calendar. Draft minutes of the regular meeting.
I have changed. I would like to add a name of another drawer to serve with Damian and Brian. And I already gave the name to Carolyn. His name is Jim Files.
Anybody else?
Yeah, I've got something on the special meeting. If I can find it. These are the minutes of the special meeting, March 8th. I want to make sure that the comment about failure to comply is failure to comply by 2022. Could open us up to lawsuits.
Anybody else? Anybody on the bills paid?
Oh, yeah. Chief?
Yes.
Let's see. Payment number 765, San Rafael overtime for 17.3K. Was that offset by any revenue or is that a standalone?
It was offset by some revenue, which I don't think we have received yet, but somewhere in the area of about $4,000.
$4,000?
Yeah. We definitely...
They're coming here more than we're going there.
They were over the last few months, and it actually was extremely helpful. Unfortunately, it cost us a few bucks, but we were short-staffed. But I can tell you this, is I did payroll today or yesterday, and there's very little overtime when we're at full staffing.
Good. Thank you.
That's awesome. Anything else?
This is probably a myth, but Carolyn, it seems like the payrolls are posted to the payment schedule about 2 days in advance of the act.
That's okay.
In this last instance, a short month, 28 days, we had three payrolls show up in February, which sort of surprised me. And one of them was posted about 4 days before the payroll. Is there a reason for that?
No.
Okay. I'm just curious.
Just when I can get to it.
Oh, okay. All yeah. Right. So there's no particular,
no.
You know, cadence.
Like
whatever.
Today, we have a payroll on Friday, and I wrote the check today. So
yeah.
I'm off next week, so I want to make sure that the money gets into the bank before I leave.
Yeah. Three payroll periods in February sort of surprised me.
Yeah. It all comes out in a wash at the end.
Yeah. I understand.
Smoking mirrors.
Yeah. Okay.
Anything from the public?
Concerned.
Consent calendar. Okay. Got a call to move to approve.
I move to approve the consent calendar as amended.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Public comment open time for items not on the agenda. Stephen.
So I wasn't here last month. I know you all missed me. I wanted to say a couple things. First of all, congratulations. I'm really very pleased with the direction the board is going in terms of setting aside funds for capital expenditure. And generally speaking, lengthening the time frame for planning. I think this is something that has been missing, and I'm glad that each one of you seems to be very much behind it. There were some other items that came up last. I noticed we have a new truck, but we don't have a covering for the truck. There was a discussion on the on the maintenance shed. I'm glad that's moving ahead as well. I just want to say one thing about the location of that. That absolutely has to be moved away from the riverbank. I know it's a difficult siting problem, but let's put it this way. I want to be a positive role on that, but I am, if it does get reinstalled at the current location, I will object at the county level and further need to, we really need to protect the watershed there and do everything we can to make sure that whatever building we do is done with a maximum sensitivity to the location. That's it for right now. Thanks.
Thank you. Anybody else? Linda?
Mm-hmm. I just want to read a piece of the board bylaws about decorum. Members of the board of directors shall thoroughly prepare themselves to discuss agenda items at meetings of the board of directors and shall conduct themselves with courtesy to each other, to staff, and to members of the audience present at the meetings. All comments should be brief and confined to matter being discussed. Differing viewpoints are healthy in the decision-making process. Individuals have the right to disagree with ideas and opinions, but without being offensive. And in the Brown Act 54954.3, the legislative body of a local agency shall not prohibit public criticism of the policies, procedures, programs, or services of the agency, or the acts or omission of the legislative body. And I would just like to say that I think it was very disrespectful of Mr. Naylor to tell me that I was hijacking the special meeting, and that, I mean, hijacking means commandeering and taking over. I felt intimidated, and I also felt disrespected. And I think you should read the board bylaws again about decorum. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. Anybody else? Okay. District matters. Here we go. We approve. We have a resolution that's coming up. You want to take care of that?
Sure. You actually don't have a resolution that's coming up, but this is, and I kind of put in the memo here, I placed this back on the board. There was a concern raised in the last meeting about the format of the agenda used. Could be a potential Brown Act violation. This is being put back on here to allow further public comment on this. Ultimately, your action would be to re-approve the adoption of Resolution 2017-02 on March 8th, 2017. If you don't choose not to reapprove, you're ultimately rescinding the resolution. The resolution will stand as is, as approved on March 8th.
And for those of the public that don't know what this is going to move special districts to voting on even years, thereby extending the four-year term for the board members currently to 5 years. It's a law that California passed last year or the year before?
2018.
And we're just trying to come up with the way in which to not hold the election currently coming up in November 17 to save at least $20,000 to get this done. We're going to bite the bullet and go for this now. We're going to put this out to the public for comment. Stephen?
Okay, well, first of all, the $20,000, that's a number that's just thrown out there. You don't know what the number is. The other thing is that you have to, the information that you voted on was incomplete. You were only presented with one option. There are several options. First of all, I want to acknowledge what Eric said, that there is a special set of rules for community services district. Now, to solve this particular problem, yes, it appears that you have to go to 5 years, but you don't have to go to it immediately. You can have the November election as and fulfill your terms as you have them currently, and then have a 5-year election, and then another 5-year election. And as long as you're on track before 2022, you've met your obligations under the law. The way you're doing it now is you're just basically saying, well, the public won't have a chance to vote on that. So I think that's the wrong way to do it. I think you should do it the right way. Have the election. Now, if you continue the resolution as you have it, you're going to have to send out notices anyhow. I don't know what the cost of election versus sending the notices out. I imagine it's a small number, but it's a small amount of money that is well spent to preserve the integrity of your office and the CSD.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Well, one of the things I said before, that I thought that it was an injustice to the voters who had already voted four of you in for 4-year terms, and so basically you're telling them, we have no choice, you got to keep us for an extra year. And there may be a possibility that some people might not want some of you board members on for an extra year, or there might be someone who wants to join the board and be unable to campaign and get votes to be on the board. So I'm just saying that it does not seem morally right to me, and I agree with Stephen about putting it to the voters for a real vote. Thanks.
Any comments from the board?
Just as I mentioned at the last meeting where we discussed this special meeting, I find this somewhat weird in that we're sort of, you know, perpetuating all of our terms by 1 year. But looking at the alternatives, it seems reasonable. And I would have a different feeling if, I know years back, there were members on the Las Colinas Valley Sanitary District Board that one of the primary reasons they were there is because they got health benefits by being a member of the board. Other boards get paid for meetings. We don't get anything but this aura of power being on the board. We're not ingratiating ourselves at all, but we're saving the district some money. And Stephen thinks maybe $20,000 is too high, but as more and more special districts opt out of the 5-year election, and if we were to stay in, our percentage of the cost of that election is going to continue to rise. And so maybe it's between $10,000 and $20,000. But it's money that could be better spent on other issues the district currently has. So I'm in favor of lengthening my term, even though personally I wouldn't mind if it wasn't lengthened.
Thanks, sir. Anybody else? I guess I will call for a vote then for approval.
We need a motion.
Motion, then.
I move to re-approve. I'm not going to read the whole thing. Do I need to read the whole thing? Okay. I need to reapprove the March 8th special meeting adoption of Resolution 2017 requiring even numbered year elections of the Board of Directors. So as to provide additional,
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 May I ask one question? Just after the fact.
We're going to move on to district
budget. Okay, thank you very much.
Draft district budget for fiscal year.
So as I put in the beginning, I'm assuming everybody kind of read the little brief memo as I put there. Keeping in mind, this is the very first budget that we've put together here for the year. It will obviously continue to grow. It will continue to evolve. Both Shane and myself and the chief of myself spent a lot of time looking at it. Departmentally, I've spent a lot of time looking at district-wide items. For a first draft at this point in the game, I actually feel pretty good about the accuracy of some of the projections that are in there. Obviously, always looking for direction and looking for feedback. Another aspect that I put in the memo was just making it very clear all of the different opportunities at public meetings of which the budget gets reviewed, gets feedback, gets direction between the various commissions and the board. One thing the board has typically done is set a public hearing, a public budget hearing for this purpose, a special meeting. I have listed some dates down there that this room is available for it. So at the conclusion of any talk on the budget and questions, I would like to, hoping that all the board members review those dates and have dates in which they are or are not potentially available, because I would like to get that set. I think it's a good practice. It's a good opportunity. And usually that is the final dress rehearsal, per se, before the budget goes on to final adoption, which is still scheduled for the May 9th board meeting. In looking at it, you know, in some of the bigger numbers, the one, you know, I encourage you at this point in time not to look too closely at the actuals. We just had a large budget to actuals review at the last meeting through Q2. If you have questions, I encourage you to ask, but I put the asterisk next to actuals up there because I haven't spent the usual time I would have going through them and making sure and doing any required journals prior to things like that. So there are some items there that still need to move around. One in particular that would jump out on an expenditure side for right now, trying to find the line item that was put into capital outlay on the parks for new equipment would be the purchase of the truck. However, that will be wiped clean because we just have to do a fund transfer through our Measure A fund, which we hadn't done at this point in time when these actuals came out. So that will come out of Measure A, not out of the general fund operating budget. With that said, I mean, I'm happy to kind of look through this and say, here's things to pay attention to. I tried to do that in the memo. Otherwise, I would just open it up for any board questions at this point in time.
I just want to put it on the record for legal fees, legal services. What is driving that?
For next year, I'm looking a little bit at actuals, plus I'm anticipating the lawsuit that the district is going to carry on for quite some time and probably incur quite a high level of fees.
Are you?
Go ahead. No.
You done? Yeah. Okay. On page two, the expenditures ending in 120 consultant fees. What consultant is that? Is that the accounting consultant?
Yeah, well, under consulting fees, is where I also put the GASB 68, all of the GASB reports that are required each year. We used a firm called GovInvest to produce those for us last time. The mandated fees that CalPERS charges us, I put under consultant fees just because they're producing the reports. And then a small amount towards an accounting consultant. I think I put a total of maybe $2,500 towards that for the following fiscal year. Mm-hmm.
The same page, utilities, gas and electric, with the installation of solar and not fully functional, could we maybe project less of a cost?
I actually looked at that pretty carefully too. I think that very well could change in time. However, I'm also factoring in the astronomical increases in gas prices, which are offsetting, keeping in mind solar. We have several meters. Solar is only affecting, albeit our two largest power using facilities, be it this building, the firehouse, and the pool. But you also have increase in PG&E electric rates as well.
I just never want to leave. the question about fire, page 9, membership dues, almost twice as much. Is that, what kind of, is that the union membership?
No, I mean, Chief, I don't, Chief and I sat down and we really looked at what all of the items are between the Fire Chiefs Association, between the CSDA, that gets split across all of the districts, which definitely has gone up as our district budget has gone up. And also, you know, I think there's what the training officer.
Training officer, fire prevention officer. Some of those costs come out of there. Really, the bigger increase just came out of the our CSDA membership and how it's broken up between the departments.
Mm-hmm. And then if you're looking at actuals on that line, there's actually some journals that need to be done there. That's where we park the union dues when we pay them. However, when Carolyn journals those out every quarter, we take those back. They're put in a benefits withholding category on the balance sheet from each payroll until we then journal them out. So the actuals are a little high on that.
Right. But they will adjust. Yeah,
correct.
And then the final question is for Rec on page 6, the marketing expenses. Any way you could lower that?
Again, that was another one that I actually looked at and took, kind of started to reallocate some things. Really looked at what exactly did we spend when we produced those two reviews. I also included the bulk mail postage involved with putting those reviews out. And then I put all, for 17-18, all website-related charges into that category as well. Because I'm trying to look at it and actually put things where they belong. Because
so
they were kind of paying
those.
You got it. Bigger dollar, the district's website is a function of marketing.
Yes. So just for the record, for me personally, in terms of the dates available for budget hearing, I would be a no on the first two, and then yes on April 25th and April 27th.
I would say last year we did it on the same night as the PNR Commission meeting, and it preceded the PNR Commission meeting. Typically it's, you know, 30, 45 minutes long, depending on how many people show up. The budget's been pretty well vetted by that point in time, so.
That's just for the record and your board members. That's all from me, thank you.
Anybody else?
I had a question on page 1 under the CSA 13 contract. Why is it down?
Could you speak up a little bit?
Oh, sorry. I just had a question on page 1 about the CSA contract. It's less for next year. Is that right?
No. The CSA 13 contract won't get finalized until after the beginning of the fiscal year because it is actually based in part on what happens this fiscal year that then carries over any amounts under or over budget are either credited or debited towards that contract. Also, the engine lease is deducted from that. Plus, the 631 was the number that was approved at May, when it was adopted in May. The actual CSA 13 contract would be double the 311 that you see there, so it'd be more like 622. So the budgeted number is a little bit high. It's just one of those situations where we placehold it in the budget until it's actually finalized.
And also, the fire department budget is down slightly also, which is why their portion of that contribution is down slightly also.
Yeah, it's based on total expense. And then
you're welcome.
It also factors in any strike team reimbursements that the district receives. The CSA 13 is credited whatever the percentage allocation is. Last year it was like 26.2. So that kind of goes back in and factors into the following year contract because in theory they have paid for the staffing of that upfront as it went. I mean, it's just how it's worked into a very long-standing 20, 30 plus year contract, it appears.
I'd just like to make sure during this budget cycle that we include some accounts for reserve accounting. I mentioned this to you before. For capital reserves, I'd like a capital reserves account set up so that we can actually commit funds to that for future equipment and maintenance and deduct that from the income statement so that the funds are there. Also for an OPEB trust account, to the extent that we put anything in that trust account, we need to you know, sort of forecast that as well. Otherwise, I did want to mention your efforts to zero suppress all of the accounts and each one of the functions that have nothing to do with that function. Makes the reports a lot easier.
Yes.
Well, thank you. That's part, and I put that in the memo. I mean, these are part of the things that are going to grow too. I still have really, and actually going through the process before trying to do that helps a lot because I'll be spreading out some of these chart of accounts items to try to make it so that regardless of department, the account is being used for as practical as possible, narrow focus. And right now we just have some accounts that are being used for entirely different functions depending on department. So that'll help to clean that up a little bit, and that'll reallocate some of these numbers. It won't change the bottom line numbers when I do this. It'll just reallocate what accounts they're going to do for a cleaner read. And that is certainly one thing, to your point, Jeff, that I have been already kind of talking with the accountant I've been working with on that, too. I mean, cleaning up the balance sheet and noting those things are all things that I certainly intend to do by the time you get something to be approved.
Very good. Thank you.
But to your other point, I'd be looking for direction as we get farther down the line and numbers become a little bit more clear, especially tax projections and so on, and how much we'd want to put into that. And I would assume in terms of reserve accounting, I mean, you would note it as a operating expense in here, and then it would basically be credited to a balance sheet account.
Yep.
Same with the OPEB.
Okay.
Well, the OPEB will just be notated in the most likely something along the lines of a funds with fiduciary agent.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Anybody else?
Yes, I would just like it noted that CSA 13 has strong reservations about paying any portion of the $45,000 legal services, which is shown in the budget, because no matter how the legal matters turn out, positive or negative, it will have zero effect on the level of service we get from the Marinwood Fire Department, and we don't feel it's appropriate to share in your problem with legal services.
This is also along the $48,000 legal expense. What I see in the budget is we're going from $18,000 for this year to $48,000 for the next fiscal year. And Ms. Perry had said that it's about expenses for the lawsuit. Now, this is the overtime lawsuit you're referring to? Is that what you're referring to, or the MOU? When you say lawsuit, you mean the overtime lawsuit. The overtime lawsuit?
Yeah, you can say it.
Yes. The answer is yes. Okay. So, what I would like to say is if you look at the other lawsuits that have been filed and the fact that they have been, the governments have responded positively to the firefighters and have given them the proper overtime calculations, and I am assuming, which you may not agree with, that's going to happen here. The way that the overtime is calculated now is wrong. It's been known for quite some time that the calculations are wrong. If you go ahead and just say, no lawsuit, let's just give you the right calculations, end of story, we don't need the $48,000. And the calculations are going to show that our firefighters are not going to get an extra, even $40,000 in extra overtime. Okay, based on comparisons to other fire stations, other numbers of employees, other people in the lawsuit, other salaries, you know, whatever. So I believe that this $48,000 is not for the lawsuit. What percentage are you thinking of legal expenses is for the lawsuit, and what percentage are you expecting is for the MOU resolution?
I don't know that I have a real answer for you on that one right now. Linda, I would tell you a large portion of it is going to wind up most likely going to this lawsuit.
Large portion, that's more than 50%.
Time will tell.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Stephen?
I said this before, I'll say it again. It's time to reassess the marketing that is being done. The Marinwood Review, sending a big catalog through the mail 2 times a year to everyone, and Votto, and all that sort of thing, to me is a putting your eggs in a small basket. I think the money would be far better spent with smaller brochures, targeted brochures like camps, like maybe even more frequent communications, but shifting towards digital media. This is what most organizations are doing now, and I think I know we've been very successful. Marinwood used to be a paper newspaper. I know the printing costs for a newspaper, it's not quite as sexy, but I think it would do the job and do the job well. And if you shift things to electronic media, like media displays out here, video, more content on the website, you'll get better quality engagement, customer engagement at a lower cost, and much appreciated by the younger generations that really don't look at their mail. Anybody else?
Are you in the younger generation?
No.
We have a board recommendation for compensation adjustment of district manager position.
Okay. Hold on. Can I stop you?
Yeah.
On G2, actually setting a date for the.
Set a date.
I think the parking, or before the parking rack, would be great if you get that done. What do you think?
It's fine with me.
Tuesday's the worst day out of all those for me, but I can make it happen if that's better for everybody.
You're true.
I think I'm out of town, and I wrote down all the dates very carefully. I don't have to move.
Oh. Okay. Yeah, that would just be one night shorter for me, which is going to be somewhat of an issue with work.
Sure.
But again, with regard to that, the 2 weeks is what, for you and staff to do final adjustments after we have our final board meeting?
Exactly.
I see. Okay. And so 2 weeks?
To me, that's a very good time. That works out fine. And again, we already have another meeting later that night as well. And we might as well back to back. And I don't have an issue with that. I just want to get the date set, and we'll start to get it out there. That this will be a budget.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
it will
be Tuesday,
April 25th is what it sounds like.
6 p.m.
That is up to you. We can, the room is available as early as 6. Allows a little bit of time between the two meetings. We could say 6:30, whatever. I mean, I serve for you. So whatever time works best for the majority of the board.
It's fine.
6 o'clock.
That's
good. Okay. And 6 o'clock it is.
Okay.
Are you asking for public comment for this?
For the date of the budget hearing? No.
No?
No. We've set the date.
Can you repeat the date again?
It's going to be Tuesday, April 25th at 6 p.m.
Thank you.
Okay. Board recommendation.
Okay. All right. Our district manager, Eric, has been in this position since January 20th, 2015. He works under a contract with the district. He is not eligible for step increases. He's one of two employees in the district that is not. His contract stipulates that he receives an annual review of his performance. To my knowledge, he never received an annual review in his first year of service, nor any change in compensation. The current board said they prepared a set of permanent and current year objectives for Eric to pursue and reviewed his performance in early 2017. He's done an excellent job growing into his position and making several difficult initiatives, managing several difficult initiatives that will help the district's effectiveness in the future. Examples include prioritizing and working with the board to create or update district policies, which have probably not been touched in over 3 decades. Championing and managing the migration to an in-house accounting system that we are now enjoying today. He earned an outstanding review from the board with a single new member abstaining. So I'm proposing, in recognition of the missed 2015 review and performance, a 4% raise pay effective the first pay period after April 1st, 2017, and to reduce the period with which he will earn an extra week of vacation by half, starting to accrue in July of 2017.
We know that Eric, as of now, has 2 week vacation, right?
I get 2 weeks of vacation, and I have a week of administrative leave, which is slightly different.
And to my knowledge, 2 weeks for a senior administrative position is kind of short in terms of vacation. And having two small children, I would definitely be in favor of the vacation. Could I look at the math in terms of... given that the salary increase will not affect our unfunded liabilities, long-term financial liabilities, in a drastic measure, I could see that being done. I mean, again, with any salary increase, our concern is not necessarily the salary, the day-to-day pay, the check, but what it means for the district's long-term obligations. What does it mean for our purse? What does it mean for the retiree health care? These are the pools that we're most concerned with, given that our liabilities are as humongous as they are.
I can comment on that if you wish.
Yeah.
Okay. Eric is in the probably the least lucrative pension plan that's offered. Yeah. To his 62. And the impact on the unfunded liabilities in the future is negligible.
For the purposes of discussion, I'll make a motion, and you can kill it if you want. I will move to approve the recommendation of Director Naylor regarding the pay increase as well as the vacation.
Second. Any comments? Public? Any comments?
Yes.
None?
Yes, I'm in favor of that, but also I'm in favor of the same sort of consideration for the fire chief. I think all the performance items you mentioned in relation to Eric also pertain to the fire chief, who's had an extremely difficult time the last couple of years due to a shortage of personnel and the juggling of shifts and the coordination that's necessary with other departments in Marin. I think he's done an excellent job, and I think it should be recognized with a pay adjustment.
Thank you. Thanks, Ron. Just so Ron knows, is that I believe we're going to go through a performance eval the department has with Eric, similar to what he went through. So
part of this, part of setting this review process up with the district manager was to make sure that it was carried out throughout the district.
Yeah, and we've talked about that a little bit. Thanks, Ron.
I have rarely come to one of these meetings. I mean, I think it's been 15 years or so. But I've been around the community and active in the community for about 50 years. And there's never been a time since I first came here when this community has been running as smoothly and as well and offered as much to its members as is going on right now. And so I think you guys are doing a great job, and I don't want you to change too much.
Thank you. Stephen?
So I want to echo what John said. It is running better, and I think part of it's Eric, and part of it's the new attitude on the board that things need to improve. It's a little awkward. I want you to consider a couple of things. The solar contract, for example, was drawn out, and I think I'm not comfortable saying, hey, everything is going great. I think there's huge room for improvement. The solar contract was delayed. No reasons given or false reasons given. We made a request in November for information. It's been 5 months, and just today I got a few little emails. But Mr. Dracozin has to follow the law, and I think he's learning his job, but he has to follow the law. He's not simply a servant of the board. He's also a servant of the public. And maybe you guys have not answered. I brought this up before regarding the California records, and you guys have given me blank stares like you're doing right now. But, you know, maybe this is why the legal bills need to go up, because you guys aren't actually following the law. And I don't want to condemn Eric. I think Eric is a good man, and he's put forth good effort. But there's definitely room for improvement. And if you are going to do this, I mean, spending money is easy. But cutting expenses, that's the tough part. We've cut some expenses, but what we have seen over the last year or two is expansion of payroll, expansion of expenses. And what we really need to do is to concentrate on more efficiency of operations. And so I'm not willing to say, you're doing a great job, here's a bunch more money. I want the board to say, look, this is what you've done. We like what you've done. This is what we want you to do better, and we want to hear your ideas of how things can be better. Because if you don't improve, if you're not cutting expenses, everything just gets more expensive, and before you know it, you guys are going to be asking for a tax increase. And so that's all I have to say.
Thank you. Linda?
Yeah, I did want to ask Mr. Naylor, those things that you read, were those goals that were set in place when our district manager was hired?
There were several current year objectives, one of which
were those goals set in place when he was hired?
No.
Okay, so they're ongoing goals as you see fit to add them to the goals.
We thought it was an appropriate thing to give him a guideline of what his objectives were.
Okay. Well, the reason I was asking is because of the new accounting system, and I wasn't sure if we all knew that there was going to be a new accounting system when he was hired. That's all I'm asking. Mm. But I would like to also add the MOU for the firefighters. It's been going on for 22 months. That's crazy. The RFP for the Park and Rec Maintenance Shed has been going on for a year and a quarter. The solar system thing, which I'm not even going to mention. But the other thing I want to add is I know that Shane DiMarta has been fabulous in stabilizing what's been happening since we've been downsized a few years back. After Gary left, you stepped in and you did a heck of a lot of work. And I know that you've been helping a lot, And I know that the chief has been helping a lot. So what I want to say is part of the district manager's recognition, perhaps pieces of it should go to these two gentlemen over here. Because I think without these two gentlemen and their expertise and their extra knowledge and their extra work and their extra effort and all of the complications that they went through and all the things that they had to do, our district would not be looking the way it is now. And I think that even though our district manager has been doing, you know, a good learning experience, I also think that there's been a lot of help from these two people. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ron? Yeah, how much money is a bunch?
Is a bunch?
That's what Stephen said. Think about giving them a bunch of money. What is a bunch?
I'm not going to answer that.
The Please. Increasing salary looks like about $3,800 a year salary total.
Just vacation? I guess that's a bunch.
Just salary. I object to the crosstalk here, and that's inappropriate.
You're inappropriate.
Stop.
Oh, don't give me that crap, lady.
Come on. Okay.
Do we have a motion? I think we
have a motion. Don't ship that. Yes. Now call for a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
And can you spell out what you just voted for?
The increase in pay, compensation.
That's it? I mean, what, with the extra vacation week and the 4%? Yes. Or
4% with the next pay period, next available pay period, and compressing the schedule to receive his next week of vacation from 5 years to 2.5 years. That will start accruing on July 1st, 2017.
Okay, so no extra benefits or anything?
No.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, on to the district manager report.
After that, real fast.
This better be good.
That would be PowerPoint.
Yeah. Okay, you know, without reading the whole thing here, we're definitely in the process of working with the, not only the county, but now the state level OES department in terms of potentially receiving financial assistance for some of the damages that were related to the storm. I just got an email yesterday. I'll be spending my day tomorrow in Santa Rosa at a briefing meeting that they are encouraging all potential applicants to go to. I did have Rachel Cannon from Cannon Hydrology and Civil Engineering came out. She did not express a grave sense of urgency regarding the damage that happened during the storms behind to the creek bank, kind of behind the pool pump house.
Really?
Well, she definitely said it needs to be addressed. She just said you're not going to show up to work tomorrow and your shed back there is going to be in the creek. With that said, you know, we're keeping an eye on it every day. Shane looked at it today, I looked at it today. The next move on that one is probably there's a local firm, Miller Pacific, that are been recommended by several people, Herb, Rachel, as well as the director from the County Department of Public Works, as a geotech engineer to come in and give it a further look. So I will most likely be reaching out to them. Rachel was going to come back out or give me a proposal to come back out and actually really look. Her initial site visit did involve her getting down underneath and taking soil samples and all that. I mean, it was a site visit and informal assessment. She lives in the area, has kids who've gone through our program, and gave me a little bit of her time, which I appreciated. Any questions on the storm-related stuff?
The governor is the one that
a little bit of everything. So the president has actually declared, these things happen in very specific windows and with very specific storms. So the one that occurred January 2nd through the 12th has actually been picked up at a federal level. That was where the majority of our damage started. It's when all of the things fell on the northernmost lawn over here. So, I mean, we're well within. I had two people from State OES come through last week, and they surveyed all of the damage. Right now, the initial estimate that I submitted was 250, and I think we've already pushed that up to probably closer to 350 when you consider all the environmental and the other people that have seemed to think that that was a unreasonable request.
350,000.
Yeah. Yeah, we're talking about doing all the civil and the shore work and getting everything up, not to mention habitat and everything else that is down there. Well, these are top ahead looks. You know, these are what I included in there. I'm moving forward along with this. Like I said, tomorrow I'll be able to get more information on the OES process too, at a briefing up in Santa Rosa. For the whole region. Solar, as you see in there, it's on, it's working. We are currently utilizing solar power as designed, as anticipated. It seems to be going good. Then the final thing on here is the list of significant dates and timelines. I know that was requested at the last meeting. I have started working on that. I just didn't have anything that was prepared to be put into the board packet yet, but we're still working on that. And then I was reminded, too, that Leah had asked about just kind of a scope of various projects list, too. So we'll see if we can keep working on that as well. Other than that, there's a lot of stuff in the pack I've been working on, so that's kind of where we are.
Okay. Any questions? Comments?
Yeah. Well, actually, it's a question. My wife was hiking along the ridge, or right behind the berries, between the in open space, and apparently there's a slide back there. Okay, I don't know. She said someone's got a tarp up there, and the engineering, is that something that we're doing, or is that the homeowner?
The homeowner.
And
we've been out there, but it's the homeowner's.
And he's doing it properly, and
The tarp is basically just to keep it from sliding any further, and then when the rain stops for a couple more weeks, we'll go up there with them and see what's what.
Okay. Yeah, I'm just concerned about liability for us. That's
all. Yeah, all we did is block off the area and put, you know, do not cross.
Okay. Thank you.
Anything else?
Is that the manager's report?
That's the manager's report.
Okay. So, well, I do not. Actually, it's just a question. So when are we going to get updates on the performance of the solar now that it's finally active?
I'll be keeping an eye on the billing and seeing how it comes in and definitely analyzing it over a period of time compared to past performance. Sure.
On a monthly basis, then?
No.
Performance basis? I mean, there was, when this was sold to the public, it was quote-unquote free, so and all kinds of promises kind of drifted away in the ether, and I just, let's keep track of what is actually going on there. Well, is that reasonable?
I certainly plan to keep track of it.
And you're going to report it in public? Like on a monthly basis?
I will put in the agenda with the important one, Stephen.
Well, they're all important. There's a 20-year commitment. So.
I think it's also reasonable to get some kind of data set to compare. So data set. So
yes, I understand what a data set is, but
yes,
isn't an electric bill a data
months,
set?
Let's wait a few months, okay? And then maybe not every month we will be looking at this data, but I don't really think we should be looking at it monthly, personally. It's up to the board president to determine the agenda, so. I'm sorry, I should not be.
Transparency, that's all we're asking for. I hope that's not too difficult.
I think that's all we've given. On to the fire department matters.
Real quick, before we get started, I just want to introduce the board to Sean Day. He's the new shop steward for the fire department. And his new lovely fiance, Leslie, recently engaged. Congratulations to him. Thanks to Sean for stepping out. As he has found out in his 2 days of service, is that there's a ton of work and a ton of time that goes into it. But I appreciate him stepping out.
Sean,
up.
I would reconsider bringing your fiance as an entertainment for Tuesday night.
Okay, that's not an exchange for an engagement. I also would like to recognize Linda Barnello because she made a very generous donation of $2,500, which is allowing Captain Brackett to go down to, where are you going?
Guatemala.
Firefighters Without Borders. They go down there and they train local firefighters on new and appropriate ways to train and fight fire, being safe, and Ryan can do that because of Linda's donation. When Ryan comes back, he's going to come to a fire commission and give a report on what he had done and what Linda's donation allowed him to do. So thank you to both of them.
Thank you, Linda.
Yeah.
Interesting. Good question.
Yes.
This is like Doctors Without Borders?
Yes, exactly.
Interesting.
It's, Sarah Fell's been doing it for a number of years, and we actually, one of our volunteer firefighters, Shane Coons, is going down also. He's been going down doing various charitable things like this through Marin Catholic for years. So Marinwood's well represented, thanks to Linda and thanks to Shane for their time. It's supposed to be a very worthwhile exercise.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Linda. How does that affect our stocking levels?
They're gone for 2 weeks. He's taking vacation. He's missing four. He'll be off for four shifts of work. He did trades for two and vacation for two.
Thank you.
He's doing it on his own time. The fire commission meeting, the minutes are before you. The important parts we'll touch on in later agenda items if you have any questions on answer.
Any questions?
No.
The activity summary, you see with February is a pretty busy month with storm calls, but again, we weathered the storm pretty well thanks to work up front by Shane's crew and by the fire guys, so knock on wood, hopefully we'll get through that. There's a little bit more rain expected in the next week, but nothing substantial, so again, I think we've hopefully weathered winter fairly well. The search trailer continues to move forward. John Schwartz, one of our volunteer firefighters, is working real hard on that. We have three paramedics on duty. Dan Rotwein and Dean Marcicini are the new hires who completed the new hire academy, are now working on C and A shift respectively. So again, one paramedic on each shift, which is great. Hopefully we can move that forward in the near future. And like I said, Eric and I have been working on budget. So we can move that forward. So any questions?
Thank you.
H3.
Right along.
So you've seen the reports over the last few weeks of the challenge that was presented us in the firehouse. North Bay Environmental has been a great recommendation. They came from Marin County Environmental Health. The mold was recognized. I called them that day. They were in the next day to do testing. They provided us a report 2 days later. They were in the following week to provide us the abatement. So we're clean. There's no more mold in the firehouse, but that also means we're kind of minus about half a kitchen. So that leads us to the possibility of a kitchen remodel. It's been talked about at the fire commission level. North Bay Environmental has an offshoot company who does reconstruction. They provided us a bid, which is before you tonight, an estimate, so to speak. They're in again today to get some additional details. They've actually are looking at the community center kitchen to provide an additional estimate for that kitchen remodel. I met with Kitchen Works, which is in Redwood Highway, next door, Redwood Highway, for about an hour last week. I sat down with them. I had measurements of our kitchen. I explained to them what happened with our mold issue. I explained to them what we were kind of looking to replace with. We're looking for cost-effective and yet durable materials to replace what we currently have. And I explained to him that I had a current bid from a company and what those numbers were, and I asked him if he could provide us a bid also, or an estimate, and he started laughing at me. He said he literally couldn't match that doubled, so he wasn't going to provide us with an estimate. They apparently do very high-end residential stuff. So I thanked him for his time, and I left. I went to Home Depot, and I'd met with one of their designers in their kitchen. The kitchen department, again, they had someone come from Home Depot, provide all the measurements. I met with him yesterday, and we sat down, and he gave me a couple of estimates. Home Depot's a little different because you have to meet with the countertop and cabinet guy, and then you have to meet with an appliance guy, and then you have to meet with the floor guy. I made it as far as the cabinet and countertop guy. He's given me two estimates for replacement of what we currently have, only for materials. One was $16,000 and one was $18,000, and that's for countertops and cabinets, not installed. That's only materials. I asked him if he could provide me a price for installation, and he said he couldn't give me an exact price because you have to schedule that with the installer who then comes out and looks at what you're doing, and they can provide you with an estimate there. But he said a ballpark figure is planned on $5,000 to $7,000. So right there, without a stove, dishwasher, or floor, we're at the budget that North Bay Environmental has provided us. I'm not sure Home Depot is the right way to move forward. I did get some feedback from Isabella at the Fire Commission meeting, and I've had talks with some of you, and I do understand the logic behind getting additional bids, and it's something Eric and I will continue to work on. But what I'm hoping for tonight is maybe you could set a ceiling at the price for the kitchen remodel, and that in the course of our due diligence with getting some additional bids, Eric and I would have the leeway to sit down with these bids and know what we were looking at and know what we could move forward and not have to wait until the next board meeting for finalization.
We don't need an RFP, I guess.
I think we were under the assumption that if it was under $25,000, that we would not need to go out for a sealed bidding process. I'd also like to note that the Fire Commission talked about this and voted on a 4-0 level to recommend that they, I'm just going to quote here, do the kitchen remodel as soon as possible, not to exceed $24,999.
I agree with the Chief's general direction. He's going in this in terms of authorizing staff to proceed at a level. I mean, at the end of the day, these guys need a kitchen, and we can't sit here and wait for the next meeting, and it's not conducive of your time to sit here and keep calling special meetings every time you come along.
Sorry to interrupt. I can tell you it's been a little inconvenient, but staff has been extremely helpful because the day before, the mold abatement thing was like, it was tarped off, and there's these air scrubbers in there, and it was a little crazy, but you know, these guys got down and dirty, made the most of it, and you know, for the most part, have been pretty positive about it. You know, just rolling with the punches there. But again, you know, we do need to provide a kitchen.
Is there a statutory limit on how much you can spend without going through a bidding process?
$25,000.
Okay, it sounded like you weren't really sure. That's what that is. Is what you were looking at to just replace what was torn out or to do the whole kitchen?
I'll answer to that fact is that we're looking to do the whole kitchen. Right now, we're roughly at about half a kitchen. A half a kitchen that's 25 years old. So it's not included here. I had some prices from North Bay Environmental just to do half the kitchen that's not existing. And we were talking about the difference of about $1,800 because all you're talking about is additional cost for cabinets. Because they're in there providing the labor anyway.
My concern was that you were, because it was something that was, we had already talked about, I think, on the Fire Commission,
sure,
that the whole kitchen needed. And relative to economy of scale, it seems logical.
Right.
If you're going to do it and get out of there and be done. And this prices here is for the whole kitchen.
The whole kitchen. And not to interrupt you, but this was actually kind of on my list for the 17-18 budget that was going to be presented to the board through meetings with Jeff Naylor and trying to come up with timelines on capital projects for the district. This was something that was at the forefront, in my opinion, that I was going to bring before the board. It just kind of got pushed up a little bit because of this mold issue, but again, that leads me to believe that it was time.
And that's why I asked the question when I was on the commission. You were talking about this.
Right.
Two more questions. You have just a one-word kind of, or two-word listing of all these various items. Are there some specifications behind them that you know what you're really going to get?
Some of the specifications are currently being worked out among myself with some input from staff with North Bay Environmental, just because I have the one bid from them. But whoever does this, I mean, eventually you have to pick what color the countertops are, what kind of materials the cabinets are made of. But the estimate that she gave us here was, I explained to her what we do there and what the use is, and she provided me mid-level reasonable priced industrial type of materials. So there could be some movement in the price downward, I believe, but what I'm looking for is these are the basic prices to get replacement on a material that we that will serve the fire department well moving forward. But that's not to say, you know, maybe it gets changed from oak to laminate or something. And I talked to her about a lot of the different countertops, you know, quartz, granite, fabricated material, stainless steel, poured concrete. And I mean, there's all range of spectrum, but really what you see before you is the price for granite, which is a pretty durable product that I think will work well. And as I've come to realize, is actually one of the more inexpensive type of materials you can go with.
Well, may I continue? Granite is probably the only thing on the list that two reasonable people could come to the same conclusion as to what it is.
Yeah.
But everything else here, there's a lot of room for variation as to what you might end up with. And that's why I'm asking, are, you know, before you enter into a contract, are you going to say, you know, there's different qualities of linoleum or vinyl floor. The sink and faucet, are you getting a fiberglass sink, a porcelain sink, a stainless steel sink?
And those
all of that sort of thing, I think, needs to be written down before any contract is signed.
And again, these were kind of placeholder prices, and that was some of the process that was started today with Christy when she was in. Hey, what is this actually going to be? What materials fall within this budget category will serve the kit, will serve the fire department well and meet the needs of what we have? So I understand what you're saying. I just don't have answers for you, but I believe these numbers will get us the type of materials we need to function next door.
No, I hear you. I just wanted to make sure before whoever's going to sign it signs it that it's that all these pieces are defined so you know what you're really going to get.
Oh, no, absolutely. I agree with you. I don't have the exact things for there. I mean, that's kind of in the weeds, and I think between Eric and myself, with input from staff, we can handle that. I'm not sure it's something that needs to become before you. You know, do you care if it's stainless steel or granite? No, what you want is something that's cost-effective and will meet the needs of the department.
And to their credit, I purposefully asked her to itemize some things out, put it on something that I could put in a back to be presented to the board, and this has all been moving very, very quickly on their end, and she had to turn this around for me within a matter of 24 hours. So to your, I believe I understand what you're saying in terms of a detail, here's what everything is going to be, actual work order that would be authorized. This is not that, or by any stretch
right.
of the imagination.
It's not a contract.
And I think it's more to kind of gauge a sense from this one company in terms of loose dollars that they're looking at for this project. The kitchen itself will mimic the current design. It's not, you know, with countersink, all that will be placed in the same areas. Cabinets will basically go in the same areas. It's not a remodel, so to speak.
And the guys understand it. I mean, we're not creating a wish list here. I mean, we're talking about new, reasonable functioning kitchen for them to use while they're on duty. I would like to get at least one more additional bid that's fairly solid to at least know what those numbers are. I can tell you this, is that Christy and her company, and Christy, just on this process, she's put a lot of time and effort into this, and I appreciate that. I'm hopeful at the end of the day that things will play out where we can work with their company moving forward. But again, I think due diligence calls for me to get at least one additional bid from one company that includes all of these things also. I can tell you, it's not Kitchen Works and it's not Home Depot. That I know so far.
Last question. If we approve this, where's the money going to come from?
General. You'll have a reserve fund. I mean, it's going to come out of the general fund.
And there's, it's there or something. This magnitude.
I hate to throw this out there because I still have a dream, but we did make $18,000 on the sale of the Type 1, and I know that the commission has earmarked that for a new utility vehicle. And I, as we move forward in the budget process for next year, I'm still committed to working towards replacing that utility vehicle, but in the interest of immediate need, maybe that money is better applied towards a commission, towards a new kitchen. But again, I don't want to throw the utility under the bus either, because I think that's something that's important to the needs of the department.
And I think it's not a huge stretch of the imagination to realize that the utility vehicle could take the place of the kitchen remodel that was originally targeted for the 17-18 season and be paid for.
Well, I have a grant out there with for the utility, so I'm still optimistic that that might come through.
I understand. I have a couple of questions. Mm-hmm. Are the upper cabinets being ripped out too?
They have not been yet. But the hope is that with what comes out of tonight, those would be replaced. And that there's some additional savings there for our staff to do the removal of that stuff.
With regard to permits and that kind of stuff, is that in it?
That's not included in this budget, but we did tell her that that would be something that we will need to have as this process moves forward. She understands that, and we've talked about the additional cost that will incur, and we're thinking it's less than $1,000.
Okay. Just want to make sure it's not going to drive you over your threshold.
Correct.
Okay. So it seems clear that time is of the essence. We've got fire teams that are in there with half a kitchen. They don't have any means of washing anything when they use it. Now, I do own stock in a company that makes paper plates, so I'd really like to see that continue. But
and we are using lots of paper plates and plastic forks and knives.
But, I think, honestly, I would like to see a second bid.
Okay.
But I would also like to give the district manager and yourself, I would like to have the board recommend that the district manager and yourself continue on this process without having to come back to us. If you can make something happen within that budget,
$24,999?
Yes. If you can make that happen without having to come back in April and discuss that, that would be my recommendation. Get this done. Sorry.
In any way we can get federal funds for this, since it was caused by water damage.
Okay, look at the plumbing issues as a natural disaster.
Can I make a motion?
Do we need a motion for this? I believe we do.
I would like to move.
Can I ask a question? After the motion, you're going to let us talk?
I'll open it up.
Thank you.
I need to authorize the chief and the district manager to proceed with the kitchen remodel, and keep the expenses to under 24,999.
Including one more bid.
Yes.
And obtaining one more bid. Thank you.
Second. Linda?
I just wanted to ask, I know that our firefighters are now eating an awful lot of takeout food. Do the firefighters pay for their own food?
They always pay for their own food, and it is actually a tax-deductible expense that you can declare.
Okay, but
taxes.
Right now what's happening is they are having a much larger expense for their food, correct?
I can tell you is that I don't know. I mean, yes, they buy sandwiches for lunch, they get pizza for dinner. It's probably more expensive than buying
making
and making your own meal.
So the longer the board waits to decide and the longer it takes to do this, the more expenses our guys are going to have for food, unless we start going, somewhere else or donating food to them. So I just want to make sure that you guys consider that. It's coming out of their pockets right now, the food.
The food always does.
Yeah, lunch usually is.
Okay. Steven?
Okay, so those of us who have done remodeling know that these prices are, reasonable for a residential remodel, but this is not a residential remodel, and I question use of grant, for example. I've been in lots of kitchens. Don't need much. Formica is fine. You're not adding value to the firehouse by goosing it up. Earlier this evening, there was concern because of the vote. Let's not waste money giving the voters a chance to vote you in for 5 years as opposed to you doing it on your own. I really question the value that you are expressing approving this. I think that a strictly utilitarian kitchen with utilitarian grade stuff is probably all you need. And it certainly could be a lot less than $23,000. In fact, maybe you'd even find that extra $5,000 it cost to have an election, have both. You have a new kitchen and voters affirming you in your position. But of course,
I'm not expecting you to agree to that, but I wanted to say that. Thanks.
Thank you, Stephen. Ron?
Yes. I'd like to express on behalf of CSA 13 that we would be pleased to pay 25% of the cost of the kitchen. Unlike our opposition to the legal expense, we think this is an item of health, welfare, and safety of the firefighters, and it's appropriate for CSA 13 to pay its share.
Thank you, Max.
Anybody else? I will call for a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you for that, and also thank you to the fire guys for rolling with the punches on this one. That leads us up to the
placement of the Marinwood cert.
So again, John Hammond is here. He will speak a little bit further on that. There's been some discussion amongst the cert advisory group along with this cert kiosk concept, trying to get additional information out to our public. It was discussed at the fire commission meeting last week, and the fire commission did also make a motion in support of the cert kiosk idea at the location in front of the firehouse. They were all in favor for that. There's a drawing that was included in the board packet of, done by John that kind of includes some of the ideas on what this thing would look like. And with that, I will turn it over to John. John Hammond, if you don't know, I'm very active in the CERC.
And thank you for
it.
Yeah. Way of background, how many of you are CERC trained besides Irv? I know Irv is, but I know you. Okay, so that's that. You all know what CERC means? Because, and I assume you all are agreed that at some point we're going to have a major earthquake. We just don't know when. So those of us who got CERC trained a while back decided that we are really totally, as a community, unprepared for a major disaster, the earthquake being the most likely one. And in the process of getting CERC trained, we learned that there are things that are done in other communities around the country where they train residents what to do in the event of a major disaster when the first responders are tied up and they're committed to doing stuff. They're just not available. But they've learned in other communities that there are things that trained residents can do to organize themselves, to save lives, reduce property damage, and come out of the event a lot better than they would without that training. So that's, CERC is all about training us, residents, to get organized in the event of a disaster. And we think the committee, the CERC committee from Marinwood, has been working on that for about 10 years now. And we've made very little progress. We've got, 5,000 people that live here. We have 70 people who are CERC trained. And we've been trying to beat the bushes to get people CERC trained and all that. But there's very little response because, you know, the earthquake is years from now. It's not going to be tomorrow. So we are in the middle of an awareness campaign to try and bring the idea of getting prepared for an emergency a little further in the forefront of people who live here. And part of that effort, the CERC committee has decided, it would be a really good idea to put a signboard, a display in front of the firehouse right next to the new CERC trailer. Remember the addition that we got that CERC trailer from the money that was raised at the last car show by the Lions Club, and the CSD board contributed money towards that CERC trailer. And now that CERC trailer is almost fully staffed with emergency equipment. But we want to put a sign up there, a bulletin board, so that we can post on there messages related to emergency preparations. And so the location we're thinking of is someplace in the proximity of where the trailer is now stored. Actually, the chief is thinking about bringing that trailer a little further forward in its parking place so it's more visible to the community as folks could travel by in front of it. And we are thinking of the signboard with maybe lighting on it so it could be seen at night. Would have information that would be important to people when they start thinking about emergency preparations. For example, we've divided the community into 40 CERT areas with the intent that each CERT area would operate as a team in the event of a disaster. People ask when we raise that, somebody, which CERT area are they in? And we have a huge map that we're preparing that will go on that bulletin board. People can walk up to the bulletin board and see their house number, what CERT area they're in, who else is in their CERT area. And We are also in the process of organizing CERT areas so that individuals know who's CERT trained in their area, they know what CERT means, they know that in the event of a disaster that their group is going to be working as a team, and they'll be encouraged to get CERT trained as well. So the signboard is the kiosk is part of our communication effort to build awareness about the importance of getting prepared for emergencies. Now, that's what we want to do. The good news for you is that the Las Galinas Lions Club has already put up to $3,000 towards the cost of materials to build the signboard, so it's no cost to the district. So the Fire Commission, as Chief said, has approved it. So what we're looking for is an approval from you folks so that we can proceed with whatever's necessary to get the thing built and up there for our community.
Any questions?
You know, it's one of the struggles that we have is that the board experience too is just getting information out to the public, and it's something that was discussed at those both at the CERT level and the Fire Commission level. And Isabel had some great ideas about getting these maps included electronically, both on the CERT website and the CSD website. And we're definitely going to move forward with that because, again, at least half, if not more, of our world does their information gathering electronically these days. Not everybody has access to the internet. There's probably a few people in this room, myself included, that don't get on the computer that much when they're not at work. So having that information displayed somewhere else for them to get up to speed on that is one of the reasons for something like this. Different locations have been discussed, utilizing future current signboards around the community have been discussed. And also one other thing is that the current state of the front of the firehouse due to the heavy rains and the construction that's been going on with solar and at the pool needs some work. Shane and I have talked about that, and as the weather continues to clear, we're going to work together to kind of improve that side driveway and some of the gravel areas. So I think maybe the actual final location of this might be affected by that, but still, again, I think the information is what we want to get out to the public, so we're looking for additional ways to do that.
I have a couple questions for John, if I can.
Go.
John, first of all, I'd like to say that how much I and I'm sure everybody sitting behind this table appreciates the work that you folks have done. I have to confess that I have been CERT trained once before. And I have to tell you that I've forgotten quite a bit of it. So, I think one of the things that, I mean, you don't want me running up and down the street putting circles and arrows on houses because I forgot what they mean. But at any rate, it seems to me that one of the most, what's paramount here is getting the word out, educating people, and doing that in the most effective way we possibly can. I've thought a lot about this. I just found out about this, by the way, Friday. I had no knowledge that this was coming, so I've been thinking about it a bit, and I'm just wondering if you would be opposed to sharing some ideas that I've got about this, and I'm going to tell you my sort of wild ideas. It seems to me that the place that you're discussing right now does not receive the appropriate level of foot traffic that you might want in order to share this message with our public. And I have some concerns about people, crossing in front of the firehouse to get to it. I know that there is space behind the CERT trailer right now. I'm wondering if the idea of a mobile kiosk has occurred, where we could move it on a special event, such as the car show, or when there are swim meets happening, to a place where a lot of people will see it, read the messages, and or have the opportunity to read it, and get your message out a little bit more widely. It's an idea. Again, anytime there's a special event or something like that, that cart with messages on perhaps both sides could be placed in an appropriate spot. The Beer Fest, the Classic Car.
Place that nobody thinks of going to that corner to get emergency preparation information now because it's not there. Mm-hmm. Our intent is to publicize that and to promote it mm-hmm. as a location and to get people accustomed to thinking about the fire department, the firehouse, the search trailer, the sign. That's where you go. That's our emergency preparation corner of the community. Mm-hmm. And it will take us a few laps, to get people accustomed to going there for the information that we posted there. But that's our intent, is to train our residents over a period of time. Mm-hmm. And we want them to see it when they drive by. You know, it's an awareness campaign. And so if they drive by at night and there's a light on it, they'll, oh yeah, that's emergency preparations. Click some thought in mind. We're trying to get that reinforcement, that message, constantly.
Yeah, I understand what you're trying to achieve. I'm just not sure about the permanent location of the kiosk. That's my
Well, idea. I think that is the right location. I like the idea of having a portable sign that we can take to events to further publicize it. That's mm-hmm. fine. We can have more than one sign.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, those are my thoughts.
My concern, I wasn't surprised by this because I happen to be at the steering committee.
Yeah, me too. But Jeff, the thing is that there are as many notions about how this ought to be done as there are people in the room. Mm-hmm. So it's a matter of we got to get beyond that point and do something.
Okay. My single concern is that if we, and I hope we will, approve putting that sign or kiosk near the trailer, that we do that with the proviso that the information that can be displayed there is related solely to emergency preparedness. Mm-hmm. There can't be a notice when the swim team is going to have a meet or when someone's yep. going to put their house for rent
yep.
or any of the other kinds of things that show up yep. on bulletin boards.
Yep. Herb, I would amend that thought that we're also thinking of it having as a place where the fire department can put up seasonal messages, appropriate seasonal messages, like the fire season is coming, or whatever seasonal message that you might want to put out there. Would be in addition to whatever emergency preparation information that we want.
I didn't discount that, those sorts of things. Can I give you an example of the kinds of things I didn't think would be appropriate?
Yeah.
As a compromise, could we do it in a mobile fashion and have it primarily situated where you want it and then move it as necessary?
I'd much prefer to have a mobile one and a fixed one. Because it's a matter of lighting, it's understanding the weather and all those kinds of things. We're thinking of something that's going to be up there for years, and so we want it to be substantial, and something that's not going to be something that's vandalized, and it's going to be able to withstand a hit and all that. Mm-hmm. And electricity going to it.
Electricity going to it?
Yeah, if we could have it solar powered, but to have adequate lighting through the winter months at night, maybe on a timer, maybe when you press a button and the light goes on, we haven't thought that out completely. But if it's up near the oak tree by the trailer.
That's on, let's see, where am I situated? That's on the other
that's
side.
That's, yeah, over there.
So that's close to, is that, this looks like a good size, really big kiosk for signage.
It's about 8.5 feet wide, and it'll be about 7 feet tall.
Will that in any way hamper visibility from the autos coming past firehouse and the firehouse leaving the house?
I'm not sure exactly where this thing would end up, but I don't think so. I think it'll just block my view.
And how close to the sidewalk then? Real close?
I haven't really finalized any of that.
It's the firehouse, not the sidewalk.
Yeah.
They're talking about walkway. Well, how else are people going to view this thing? they have to walk up to it, right? So they're going to have to cross off, cross over.
Well, it could be. It could be in the proximity of the sidewalk. You know, maybe an area that's just off the sidewalk that where it could be, and people can walk up to an area that's prepared for them.
Yeah, to walk. I've never. I think the only time is walking around the neighborhood, just walking past the firehouse from the street coming off of. It just doesn't. I don't know. There's not a lot of traffic there for people. Go for it.
So I just for the record for the board meeting, I'd like to kind of bring back my thoughts from the fire commission meeting, slightly enhanced, maybe modified. First and foremost, thank you for John for his activism and energy on the CERT effort. I think it's, you know, we all know it's coming, and we all know we have to be prepared, and we probably all are not doing enough to prepare for it. Secondly, my father was involved in industrial design, and if he were here, he would probably say that a sign will not create foot traffic. You have to bring the sign to where the foot traffic happens already. And in the interest of your money being spent most efficiently, and in the interest of getting you the biggest bang for the buck, I would strongly advise against building this kiosk as planned over there, just because there is no foot traffic there. Where we get foot traffic is close to the community center, the lawn, the pool. This is where the heart of the community center activity happens. I know during the commission meeting, I believe it was Linda who said that, you know, just in case of emergency, where are people going to go? We are going to go to the firehouse. But you actually want to spread the information about availability of the training beforehand. And so I would be in favor of utilizing current message boards. And I also agree with the more visible points for your CERT awareness, the better. We have several boards throughout the property where you could prominently display information about the program, the training, the website, you know, maybe even having brochures that for people who do not do internet. I'm not in favor of the, as you know, but just for the board members, for the public, I'm not in favor of the kiosk. Also, in terms of just aesthetics, you know, we could also say, you know, water devils had such a prominent feature of our community. They should also have a kiosk somewhere close to the road. So then we'll start putting up kiosks, and I just don't think it will fit into a cohesive design of this center. So again, whereas I applaud your commitment and you've spent a ton of time just even coming to the meetings, I have to say I'm not a big fan of this.
I agree with Isabella. I think the location is, I understand the idea of putting it there. I just think it's not going to be the best use of the money and the time.
I'm sorry, could you speak up a little bit?
Yes, I'm just saying I just don't think the location is a suitable location for this. So I think it's a great idea. I just struggle with the location because I have never once, only when I parked illegally to pick my kid up from camp, because I ever parked somewhere where I've had to walk by there. And that's usually looking over my shoulder and running both ways. So, I don't have a great answer of where to put it, and I wish I did.
I kind of like Jeff's idea of a mobile.
I wonder, would you be interested or be willing to have a member of the board attend one of your meetings and discuss that with the
your committee and MCA?
I think you find the same discussion there that you're having here. Everybody's got a different idea.
Sure, I understand.
But my interest, my feeling is that we want to create an area that is an emergency preparation area that people is dedicated to that, that people start to recognize that it's a place where they go, not mix it up with other messages that are about swim team.
Sure.
That's the whole idea.
Sure.
So if we put it someplace other than in the proximity of the trailer and the firehouse, then as far as I'm concerned, the whole why gets lost. You know, we've got to accomplish what we're trying to do. The idea of a portable one, I think, is a great idea. I think having something we can take to events and put up. But we already do this. We set up a CERT booth at the 4th of July. We talk to people. We have them give us their email address so we can communicate them with our email address system. We hand out brochures. We do all that kind of stuff at events. We don't do it at swim meetings. Things. I don't think it's an appropriate place.
Right, it's just that, that's where there are a lot of people congregating. And
yeah, there. But they're there for a mission. They're not there to...
Sure, I understand.
...that scam over them about getting surgery. So, but the 4th of July, when they're standing in line to buy their tickets for a pancake breakfast, that's a good opportunity. They're talking with their neighbors, and we do accost them.
Yes.
And those are that kind of event. And we've done it at the music in the park and So I think that's we have already doing what you're talking about, going to places where people are gathering. What we're talking about is having a dedicated emergency preparation site, the trailer, the firehouse, the kiosk.
Can I make a suggestion? Is that the CERT committee meets monthly. We're meeting Tuesday the 27th at 7:30. And I'm just trying to remember what it said on the calendar. I'll send out a reminder to you. I think the information that we want to get out to the public through something like this is of very good value. So I see the value in getting the information out. I think maybe our CERT committee can continue the dialogue as to how and where to best do that. And we, of course, would encourage anyone who's interested to come to one of those meetings and assist us in that. But from what I'm hearing tonight, maybe right now there doesn't seem to be the support for the current location. That's not to say maybe down the road minds won't be changed, but again, this isn't a dead issue, no matter what, depending on what the board decides tonight, because the CERT committee is going to continue to move forward with ways to get information out to people.
If there's not some sort of I know this is about emergency, but if there's not an emergency timeline, I'd like to suggest that we table this for this meeting and carry it to the next meeting. And I would like to do some more investigation, and I would like to talk to John further on this and understand better what's, what the pulse is of the organization, and see if we can come to a conclusion that hopefully serves everyone. That's just a recommendation.
It's viable right now, concerning that. I think Herb may be the only one here that's going to approve this tonight.
Possibly.
Probably.
But, one of the things that hasn't been mentioned is that CERT Group had a graphic of this fantastic map reproduced that about as small as you can get is this about 8 feet long by 3 to 4 feet high so that it's readable. Mm-hmm. It has the whole neighborhood with all the street addresses, and then it's divided up into the CERT areas and color-coded to some degree. And to display it, it takes something about this size. It's too bad you or your predecessors voted to remodel the center and fill in that center courtyard, because if that was still there, there were some great concrete block walls where this could have been mounted.
You're sitting where you used to serve pancakes right out of there.
Yeah, that would have been a great spot for it, but there isn't any wall space left anymore.
I don't want to discount it out of hand. I would just like to take a little bit more time to think about it before concrete is poured.
With that being said, too, what Herb brings up is there's some really cool mapping stuff that's been completed by a fella named Spencer, who's a volunteer at county OES, and he's got a private consulting firm. He's a tech head. I mean, we've worked on getting these maps reproduced for years, and what Spencer has produced is really what we were hoping to see. It took us a little time to get there, but it's pretty cool, and it's interactive with phones, and so it's good stuff. You know, that committee's moving forward. The trailer continues to get worked on. Again, garnering interest in bodies is kind of our next step.
Is the map on the website already?
It's not yet, but it will be by the end of March.
So yeah, one other thing that I haven't mentioned is that part of our publicity campaign for awareness would be after this thing is constructed, presumably out in front of the firehouse, that we would hold a party. And we would invite the community to attend and barbecue hot dogs and have some music and we get some talk about CERT and introduce people to the kiosk and what its purpose is. And with free hot dogs and music, we ought to be able to get a couple hundred people out there anyway and have some fun. And so then they'll be talking about it. And so it's just part of the awareness campaign to imagine to get people accustomed to going to that location to remind themselves what CERT is and check when CERT training is scheduled, get ready, classes are scheduled, first aid, you know, all that kind of stuff. And that's the place we would train people to go. And we can, Isabel, put notices on other bulletin boards around the community saying, hey, here's what you can get by going to the kiosk. You can learn about CERT training, you learn about all these things rather than taking up bulletin board space. We don't have room to put up a fan, the maps and all that kind of stuff, but any other bulletin board in the area, we have to have a dedicated bulletin board for it.
Okay. Thanks, John. Well, I'll ask for a motion. Since this is what we're supposed to do, is that unless we table it?
Well, you have a requested table, so I would go with that first, but you should also take public comment.
I'll take public comment. Stephen?
First, I have a question, John. On CERT, do you get involved with evacuations if there's like a fire or terrorist event? Is that part of your functions, or is it just pretty much
Steve, you ought to get trained. You ought to sign up for CERT training and get it, because CERT is would be evoked whenever there is a disaster such that the first responders were preoccupied and unable to come to the aid of people in need.
But are you trained in evacuation? That's
no, we're not trained in evacuation. We're
that's
trained
typically not a duty that the CERT folks would be responsible for.
We're trained to help people when there's people injured, when there's fires.
Okay, so thank you. I just wanted to clarify that. First of all, I want to say I actually agree with most of the board and in particular Isabella's father, my previous life I was sold outdoor advertising and advertising in general, and you've got it, the idea, if you want to get a message out, you've got to get eyeballs on whatever it is. So location is very, very important. Now I'd like to suggest, and fortunately Shane left, but most communities, many schools, they have like a tri-cornered or an octagon-shaped thing that says, community information, and there, what I would suggest is we create a kiosk for that, for community information, and on one panel would be CERT, another panel would be, you know, schedules, maybe another panel, public notices. The big panel would be for entertainment, and then also classes. You could just put this, and you put this center in a very chronic location, and actually I think the best location for me would be right as you are entering the sidewalk to the pool, right in that area where people walk by that constantly. I that's probably the highest trafficked area in our community. And then also, because you want to take a deeper dive into some of these issues, perhaps a sign that would either maybe attach to the trailer or maybe some accessory area where you could have more information. But if you have the eyeballs on the information, you have one area very prominent that says community information. Each panel will be separate, so you don't have that problem that you're concerning, people, lost dogs, lost pets, that sort of thing. Locked cabinets. It makes so much sense. I don't know what to say, but that's what I would advocate, and it won't cost you more than what you're proposing.
Anybody else?
I'd like to table this to the next meeting. I'd like to suggest that we table this to the next meeting. I would like to take some time to understand it better, to work with John and his group, and have a better idea of what it is we're signing up. I have learned quite a few things tonight. Number one, size evidently is an issue.
Size matters.
Yes, evidently. But it sounds like in order to actually get any value out of this map, it's going to have to be larger than the bread box. So that's something I did not know before. I just like to understand this better before we, start pouring concrete. But I'll be happy to work with you.
Are you creating a committee of one?
No, I just volunteered to pursue this a little bit. So I'm not trying to create a committee.
We're not creating any committee.
27th.
Does it sound like this?
Yeah.
Does it sound like I'm creating a committee? Because I didn't intend to.
Tuesday, March 28th.
It does.
Oh, okay. I'd just like to table this until the next meeting.
And so we would need a motion to table.
I make a motion that we table this and put this on as an agenda on the April board next month.
Okay. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Date of the next Fire Commission meeting is April 4th.
Yes, Fire Commission will be April 4th.
I'd just like to say one more thing as we're talking about the fire department right now. We're about 3 weeks away from the April 8th anniversary of the JPA that we're currently operating under with San Rafael. The primary benefit to this community of that JPA was to put paramedics on our trucks. We have three certified paramedics now, but we are unable to have them serve as paramedics. I just wanted to express my disappointment with that. The chief has done what he can to hire these folks. We're happy to have them on board. We would like them to be serving as paramedics. It's a long overdue.
Thanks, sir. On to draft minutes of the Park and Rec Commission meeting. For review.
No, because we're going to be discussing the park plant power, I believe.
That's up next.
Yeah, which was the main
Yes, on the draft minutes,
yes.
For the park and rec, yes. I was at the meeting, and I think Mr. Naylor was there as well, weren't you? At the park and rec?
Yeah.
Okay. And what I recall is that Ms. Call handed a piece of paper to Carolyn, asking for additional information being added to the minutes. And it was like a big paragraph. And I think it's, this big extra paragraph right here in the middle of the draft minutes. And I recall John Campo saying, but that's not what you said. And then it was just kind of passed over, and she read it to everybody and she handed it to Carolyn. And so I didn't know what happened with that, but here I see in the minutes that Sullivan commented the verbiage is now included in these minutes. Well, this verbiage that she gave, that she handed over on a piece of paper, was not from the meeting. It was something that she added to, she expanded on, she had other ideas. You know, it's more difficult to talk off the cuff sometimes in meetings and say what you, everything you really want to say. And so I think she probably was just thinking afterwards, well, I should have said this, I should have said this, I should have said this. But if you read this, and like I said, Mr. Campo did say, this is not what you said, and you were there. Remember him saying that?
I do.
Okay. Why are we adding a paragraph to the draft minutes when it was not said? I know this is something that a previous director or two used to do, but I mean, this was real obvious, and it was commented on at the commission meeting, and yet I noticed that it's in here. So why do you add something to the minutes that were not said?
If I can respond. It wasn't added to the January minutes that she wanted it added to. This is actually the February minutes, and this is making recollection that she asked to add this, and then it clearly says, motion second Campo 2 to approve draft minutes of January 24 with no changes.
It says the verbiage is now included in these minutes.
The current ones that you already did.
The February minutes.
They did not approve the January minutes with Kimberly's additions after the fact. What she read out loud was a prepared statement. That was included in the February minutes because those were the words that she spoke at that time.
Okay, so I get. I'm sorry. I didn't understand the way this was said.
That's why the motion stated that it's that I said it that was not as amended.
It was included in the February minutes that she would like to amend the January minutes, but it is also noted here in the January minutes that they adopt them without this addition, with no changes.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Anything else?
Lieutenant Ed, just you're just talking about the report, correct?
We're just talking about the draft minutes.
Okay.
On to the plant ballot.
I can take this if you want. I was hoping somebody from the commission would be here. I will say the commission has spent a lot of time, you know, discussing and working on this between, you know, both John Campo as well as John Toon, who are longtime professionals in park maintenance as well as arborists and things like that, various certifications. I think that their goal was to begin to create some levels of consistency as well as to be able to provide a guide for staff of plants that would potentially thrive throughout the area. This is simply that. It's a growing, evolving document. I certainly applaud their efforts. I think it's a good thing for the Park and Rec Commission to come on and to take on. It's, you know, especially when you're looking at kind of park beautification and you have the expertise of what we have. They were very meticulous in selecting these plants and, you know, and looking at them. They are eyeing some areas through one of the facility tours of the park that we have noticed is could certainly use some level of plantings or shrubbery just to provide a natural barrier because it's kind of an empty, dead space that then eventually goes straight into a little ravine that feeds into the creek. That was kind of where this started. Again, I don't want to entirely speak for them. I would have preferred one of them would be able to be here tonight to speak to it, but I certainly applaud the efforts. This is put in here tonight simply for board review. to look at to see things that the commission has been working on. They did spend a lot of time. They have talked a lot about this, and it's just being presented for reference material for the board.
Well, it sounds like the palette that they're suggesting is going to help save water and reduce maintenance.
Sure. I don't know if it's going to save water over what we currently have. It is. These are drought-resistant plants. These are plants that, you know, moving forward, you can put in there that will certainly won't require as much water as other types. These are all local native that thrive in this area. Would that make sense?
Which means we're not watering them as often as we are the other.
Correct. And that's when they're actually looking at specific kind of plantings in specific areas. It's also including watering plants, what type of water areas, is there sprinklers, what is there? I mean, these two are incredibly well-knowledged in park maintenance. I know Victor came down to, who's on our park maintenance staff, came down and joined the commission meeting at one time too, and certainly engaged in conversation and educating them on, well, there are already lines run to here or there, we've just capped them because we don't have anything growing in one particular area.
It's a great idea.
Yeah, what it does is it, number one, they identified some criteria, you know, and actually discussed them. Well, you know, drought tolerance, native, you know, what sort of insects and this and that they attract and all sorts of other things. It was very well thought out, I believe. And it is not a final document. It's subject to, you know, change, subject to additions. I think somebody mentioned recently trees being added. I think that's certainly a possibility as well. But it does at least give us a foundation where when plants need to be replaced, we have choices. And we have choices that have been well thought out and can be implemented without a lot of pain and agony.
That's exactly what I applaud to the foresight. Basically, you know, we are moving from being a reactive district to kind of try to look forward as much as we can and be in control of what's happening.
To, if you remember our interesting discussion about the landscape berms in the Visalia Estates, and we had a neighbor up there just going, plant some trees. It would have been good if first he had asked, and second, if we had a plant palette that included trees. And so I think it would be very good for the Parks and Rec Commission to take the next step and add trees to this. Because I think trees more than shrubs are the kind of thing that maybe people would volunteer to plant, and we would have asked then some direction for them.
Certainly one of the things we're working on, and not just trees based on where you're putting them to, trees that grow good along sidewalks, trees that are wise to put underneath where you have overhead power lines, trees that are more for open space. That's more of Commissioner John Toombs' wheelhouse. I mean, he's certainly the arborist. He is accompanied Shane primarily on many walks around the grounds, inspecting some of our areas in terms of just gauging the overall health of the various species and trees that we have.
Else?
I had a question. First of all, these plant palettes, are these for actively landscaped areas? So in other words, these could replace the flowers that you have growing out in the boxes here, or is this something that if you're going to put in a row of, I don't know, a border like on the berm, you might use these as opposed to something else? So I guess what I'm asking is this a something that you're using to actually, you know, maintain, or is it just plants that you use to go out?
So both. We're trying to get away from the more ornamental stuff, and replace them with the more drought tolerant species. So yeah, it could go in either spot, both landscaping closer to the community center and also things you might find out in the park.
Okay. Well, I just want to say I love the idea. I think it's fantastic that people put forth the effort. And also, what Herb says, including the trees, that's very important because we have enough Scotch pines growing
in our community.
Anybody else?
No.
Okay, it sounds like we should go on to the park maintenance facility replacement initiative. This is, we're approving this, Eric?
Potentially. So what I put in here, is, and I'm going to let Irv start to speak to a lot of this because he's kind of our resident expert as we get there. What I put in here is, you know, a little memo to the board in the packet. One of the actions that I would certainly like to see happen by the board is looking at, ideally, if possible, we can set a date to have this kind of community input meeting, but I think that that'll be the end of the conversation here. It'd be good to identify a time when we can do that. The more we can get the word out about that, I think the better, and go from there, keeping in mind that you've already taken off Tuesday, April 25th, unless you want to make it the actual Park and Rec Commission meeting topic of the night that night. Because preceding the Park and Rec meeting, you're going to have the budget.
Yeah, I understand.
Love you.
What does Shane have to say about that? Do you want your Park and Rec, your April Park and Rec meeting to be taken over entirely by the chef?
Happy birthday.
Yeah, I'm fine with that. Yeah, I don't think there's anything pressing in April.
You're sure?
The chef's important.
Budget's important. The public wants to know about the budget. The shed's critical.
That's a good one. Yeah.
You know, do you need to talk to Shane Valentine? Whether his meeting wants to be taken over?
We can certainly do that. Certainly. Good point. So let's talk to Shane and see if he has any particular brothers about that. That's one to suggest. And that might be a good opportunity to get as many people. You know, I'm sure we'll have some people who are bordering where the shed is right now, wanting to offer their opinions. And we'd like to also excite some people who are interested in making sure that our staff is operating in a safe facility, and you know, that the facility will be as efficient as possible. And back to something that Stephen said earlier, it appears that in these drawings, there is some movement of the site. It's not in the exact same place. It looks like it's being placed further away from the creek side, which is probably also not a bad idea.
Yeah, and again, I'll defer to Irv to really talk about this. But just even kind of, you know, Shane and I were looking at some of these too, and looking at the option two, where, you know, it really kind of reroutes the whole little road there.
Yeah.
It was something we never really even thought about, but I thought it was, you know,
it's
pretty clever.
It seems brilliant because then you would have maybe even more nature-like, I don't know, experience by just having buildings on one side versus going in between buildings, and would definitely provide a more safe area for the buildings being further removed from the creek. So anyhow, may I just ask that once you confirm with Shane that April 25th is a go, can we make sure to do the usual next door, neighbors, Facebook?
We'll get it out as much as we can.
It sounds like a sandwich board kind of meeting.
Well, and we'll also actually do, we'll come up with some level of notice for that's, you know, beyond just your standard agenda, and most likely mail it directly to those immediate impacted neighbors there too, so they certainly are aware of it. But we'll sandwich board it at the trailhead there. We'll put it on next door. We'll do the neighbors. We'll put it on the website. We'll, I mean, the goal is to make as many people aware of that meeting as possible.
Yeah, understood.
And then with that, like I said, in terms of actually talking about these, I would defer to Irv if he's, you know, very sort of.
Okay, if I may, at the last meeting I told you I had in my head three professionals that we might be able to get to do some drawings at no cost. I called Bill Hansel. He said he'd love to do it, but he's slammed with work, and it would be a couple of months before he could even think about it. Mm-hmm. The second person I thought of was Dave Paoli, but then I remembered that he's on the County Planning Commission,
we may want to save him for something later. And the third person I called was Joe Ronco, who's a principal with SWA. And he said, sure. He said, I said, we're looking to do something to remodel or to replace the maintenance shed. He said, oh, you're going to change to a different color tarp?
Yeah.
So I knew he was interested in the project right away.
That's phase one.
Yeah. In any event, what Joe did, and I didn't, the only thing I gave him was a topographic map. His people came up with those two options. Mm-hmm. But he's prepared five exhibits. You have them on 8.5 by 11. The two options for the siting of the facility, I think, are very interesting. In both cases, they're set back from the creek, but option two sets back even farther and lets the pedestrian path and all the between the facility and the creek. And while it moves the maintenance facility closer to the homes on Quietwood, it provides them with a blank wall. There's no openings on that side that would generate any noise or anything.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I think it's very important that this board takes no position on these options.
Mm-hmm.
You need to go and listen to what the folks in the neighborhood, in the district, have to say. So I don't, the only thing I think you should be approving is whether you want to go with these documents to a workshop and then schedule that. And I think I'm available the 25th, and I won't know till I get home tonight. And I would like to be there, of course. But Director Naylor was concerned about the architecture of the building. And I truly think that 95% of the issue is going to be the siting mm-hmm. of the building. We're not going to build a two-story building, I don't think. I assume if we're going, and Shane was saying that it must be the roll bar on the tractor is pretty high. I don't know how high it is, but I don't know what kind of clearance we would need, because it's my desire that all our rolling stock be put inside a building where it can be locked up, mm-hmm. not parked out in this fenced area. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, like I say, what's the highest thing we have, but the roof's going to have to be high enough, at least a part of it, so that thing can get under it.
Correct.
And a door set up so that will work. But I really, don't think architecture is going to be that big of a deal. It's going to be where the facility is located.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the footprints that we've laid out here probably is a little generous, which is good, because the subsequent step would be to hire an architect to do the space planning to figure out exactly what is needed, come up with then the rendering, the building design or type,
mm-hmm.
And then maybe come back to the board. I don't know if you want to do a full-blown workshop for that time. But then you go to the county and see what they're going to say. I know they're going to say the farther you get away from the creek, the better.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we should use these exhibits. I can reproduce them in my office 24 by 36, so we can have a set that people can actually walk up to and look at as compared to these small ones.
That would be great.
At no cost.
I agree with you that 95% of this is all going to be about location. And I think this does give us enough, and more to the point, we're so far behind schedule already. The sooner we get this out and we get that public meeting going, the better. I have no concept of how long it would take once we get input from the public and we start to work with an architect, start to think about permits and all these other things, how long that's going to take. And it would have been really, really swell to start breaking ground and working on this when it's not raining cats and dogs. I just don't know what our timeline's going to be at this point.
A year from this summer.
I would say probably at this point you're right. But we need to move on this. And I think this is great, and I would like to I'd like to work on a letter of appreciation to Joe for putting in his time. And I hope we can get this meeting going on the 25th. And again, we will cover this off with Shane, too, as well.
I have a question, I guess, for Shane, because the drawings show, like, I think the Gaga ball court looks permanent.
Yeah, we're putting concrete in the center of that thing. it's become a fan favorite. So.
You know, the only other thing I saw in these drawings, well, first of all, what are these little, these things that look like parking spots? Is that where the gravel and mm-hmm. all that stuff's going to go? Okay. The turning radius on some of these was a little bit of a concern for me. You know, getting the vehicles in and out of the bays was the only thing I saw that looked a little...
I actually thought those were parking spots, to be honest with you.
Well, yeah.
That would be a good question to ask, because...
Well, tell me what you mean. I can answer that.
Oh, okay. These vertical lines next to the office, for instance.
If you look at the original approval of the office building, that's where the parking was supposed to be.
Right.
There's now a landscape mound there.
Yeah, exactly.
And they park alongside.
So the thing that they wanted are bins for all of their, you know, gravel and
they built
mulch and all that other stuff.
Go inside the fence there.
That could be.
I'm a great believer in everything contained inside something, a building or a fenced enclosure.
Right. Yeah. Because those were sort of open for opportunity, I think, the way they are now, outside the building. So. Anyway, this is great. It gives us something to visualize and for the public to visualize, as you point out.
Because we have, for sand, we want sand to be available to everybody in the community, but let's say like the gravel, mulch, or whatever, that would be just for our landscaping purposes, so that could be enclosed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it doesn't have to be inside.
Well, I think this is just a concept, but I think it's enough to get people talking and hopefully agreeing on some idea. Then you're going to have to hire an architect who will do space planning, mm-hmm. and then design a building and enclosure and whatever to make it all work.
Yeah, I think the ultimate goal would be including people who would otherwise object to this and seeing if we could include their thoughts in a design, as opposed to just having them fight this entire thing. You know, by giving them the opportunity to weigh in and, you know, make suggestions.
Yes. And the other thing I want to make loud and clear, this first phase came in completely within budget.
yeah, indeed. Okay. That's great. Thank you.
Any comments from the public?
Yes. First of all, the great work. I'm glad you're moving along on this. And Irv, I mean, I love the idea of the road going along the creek. I think that solves some problems that we've been trying to address. I do, you know, I live on Quietwood, and also I was involved in the pitching of the public the first time round, and it didn't go well, and the reason why it didn't go well is there wasn't a vision to sell. Tom Horn said, well, what do you think about this? And then he said, well, if we build it, would you just simply agree to it? In other words, he didn't really have a concrete plan to say this is what we want, this is what we think we should build. And I think it's important because each homeowner had the same objection. When he said we're building a building, each one of them had their own idea of how ugly it could be. So you really have to be very, very careful on the way that this comes before the public. Now, I do have some suggestions myself. First of all, we only have three people in that department, and they're working outside every day. I think that if we could contain their office within the main facility, I think that would be better, and then we can use this trailer for, say, a outdoor education, accessory camp, just an extra space. It's actually quite a bit of space and it has a toilet, and the guys could also use the toilet during the day. So I think we should think of, in terms of accommodating the office space, which is really minimal. It needs a desk and some chairs and maybe a table to sit around and have lunch and some lockers. But it doesn't require all this space. If you did that, you could reduce the footprint of that area. Now, having everything contained, I also agree, is very important. Getting a rolling stock in a locked area, I think, is vital. We did have our dump truck was stolen a couple of years ago, and you know, we do get vandalism down there. And we now have a very nice and desirable vehicle. When the car thieves see it, they may decide it's worth the effort to jack that. I like the idea that everything's going, but I think more ideas need to be fleshed out and brought into more refined form before you get before the public, because what you don't want is another negative experience. You don't want to create more resistance out there. So, yeah, good work.
Anybody else?
Yeah, I don't have the pictures with me, so I'm not exactly sure how to put this, but where the lines were that some people thought might be parking spaces, I figured those were for, you know, gravel and dirt and stuff. But I also thought that that's where the doors into the building were going to be, because Park and Rec Commission said maybe 6 or 8 months ago that they wanted to have the doors opening up into the area, into the building on the side, so that it would be easy to get in and out on the side.
Right.
So, right, but if so, that kind of conflicts with putting the piles of gravel and dirt and everything in certain locations. But anyways, that was just one point. The other thing I wanted to ask about was the wood chip pathway that goes behind everything, that goes along the creek. What I was thinking about the very first minute I saw that was, aha, this is a great way for kids to play. They're going to be riding their bicycles on this pathway along the creek, and they're going to be making little jumps into the creek. A lot of kids, a lot of people with dogs, make their own pathways going down into the creek. And throughout the panhandle, there's lots and lots of places where kids go down, a person made, a kid made, pathway into the creek, and they play in the water, and the dogs jump in the water, which they're not supposed to do. It's against the rules. But I'm just thinking about the erosion. It looked to me like this little pathway behind the building and next to the creek is going to be a great place for a lot of kids and dogs and people to be running around down into the creek and eroding the side, you know, and damaging the creek bed. So I was just very concerned about that. As far as liability goes, kids climbing down, kids making more pathways, more erosion, more damage, whatever. So I don't like the idea. I mean, I love having a little pathway, but I don't like the idea right next to the edge of the creek. Because we've seen what, on the panhandle, how there are a couple of areas on the panhandle where the pathway has been narrowed and narrowed and narrowed because of erosion. So that's just something I think needs to be thought about before you really, really want a play pathway, and that's what it's gonna be. Because those are kids coming from school, and lots of people walking their dogs into the creek. That's my biggest concern.
Again, to reinforce, there are no sand bins or rock bins shown. Those
right.
are parking places
right.
per the original approval of the office.
Yeah, you answered that. Thank you. Yeah.
So, one other question or comment. I thought a prefab building, like most of these facilities, parking maintenance facilities, are
was the way that you're going. I mean, you talk about architects customizing here, and all I'm hearing is it getting much more expensive than probably needs to be. Was there a determination that prefab wasn't the way to go?
Yes. That was decided months ago.
Because they wanted to build something different?
Yeah. That was decided. Remember, Eric, that was the outdoor Park and Rec Commission meeting where the solar guy came?
I don't think anything's been decided.
Well, okay.
Yeah.
Nothing has been decided, but it's been on paper that it would be much better to have an architect and build it ourselves and put the windows where we want it, put the doors where we want it. And that guy from the solar said it would not cost that much more.
I think what it was stated wasn't anything if it would be that much better. So when you look at the things and the levels that you want to do to kind of customize the building to meet your needs, you
yeah.
might not achieve the level of savings you would think you would by going with a pre-manufactured building.
That was basically
something like that.
Yeah.
But I mean, you know. Yeah.
But nothing along those lines has been decided.
Oh, yeah. For what we're trying to do
exactly.
with this approval, we're going to approve the initiative.
You're going to approve the use of these drawings for a community input meeting, basically, is where you're at.
Stephen?
Yeah, I've given you some feedback, and you can hear it at the meeting, but...
That's what it's for.
Okay, well, if you'd like to hear objections at the meeting, I'm just saying I don't think it's ready yet. I'm glad that you're doing it, but I think you need to take in some more factors before deciding this is it. These are the choices, two choices.
These aren't the choices per se.
Okay.
These are drawings that are going to be open to public view and have them have their say,
okay.
just like you're having your say tonight.
Well, okay. I mean,
so I call for a motion.
No, that's good. Thank you for explaining that because it's not what it says on the agenda. Thank
wait
you.
For his ability.
She has faith in you.
I just don't want you to run into a brick wall. This is just the beginning.
I think you're not ready.
I think we're ready to get input, and yes, some of it might be.
Because that's exactly what happened. It started objections right away. One guy threatened, well, if you do that, I'm going to force the EIR. And so these are the factors that are, you don't want to build a resistance before you.
No, we don't. You're right.
Yeah.
We want to invite people who are going to most likely have some objections to this and see if we can engage them in helping us define where things are going to be.
Okay.
You know? Better in my short history, it's been better to get your message out as soon as possible and engage people as soon
mm-hmm.
as possible, even though you would anticipate there's going to be some sort of negative feedback. That gives us time to work with these people and hopefully get them working on a solution as opposed to fighting with us about it.
Yep.
So.
Well, if I may comment, so the 100-foot setback, and that's what it is, could present an intractable objection. And if someone says, well, I don't want behind my house, besides which this isn't 100 feet out, if you hadn't thought, game plan this all out, you have no place to go. So I know what the people are going to say, and there's going to be one person, the LGOs will probably go, yeah, go ahead and note. Everybody else there is going to have an objection. So it's five homes.
But that's what the whole purpose of this is, to invite them in.
Sure.
Okay.
Well, okay. But
that's what the purpose is, and I want to call for a vote. A motion first. Motion to approve.
Yes, I'd like to propose that we use these drawings as a starting point for a public meeting, possibly scheduled on April 25th as part of the park, if not part of, the entire Park and Rec Commission meeting to engage the public in the review of these preliminary drawings and seek input on them.
I'll second that.
Call for a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Staff recommendation to purchase accessories.
Yeah, I can start with this. Much better than the same thing with the firehouse. This was certainly important that we got from one of the more active shops in the area that does this kind of work. With the truck that we bought as a fleet vehicle, it came bare bone. It did not have a lot of these things that are simply needed to be more useful as a work truck. Some of them are more important than others. Certainly not all of these need to be purchased to tomorrow. Some can wait even until the next budget year, but in looking at them, certain ones need to go soon. The spray and liner, the steps on the side, those are things that I would absolutely recommend. We put on there, obviously this isn't a budgeted expense. I wouldn't recommend pulling this further from Measure A. I would recommend moving this from general operating. The total dollar amount on here for everything is about $5,800. Some of the things that we would suggest, if needed, putting farther down the line would be the high side aluminum boxes that are basically toolboxes that get mounted on, while convenient to have, certainly not a necessity at this moment in time. And even the safety light crossbar, the light to go across, can certainly wait at this point in time. That would knock a significant chunk off. The lumber rack, the rack that we would put on it, is certainly not as critical as some of the other things I mentioned, but absolutely a useful item to have on there all the same as these guys, especially start moving lumber around and things along those lines. That actually has to get fabricated. It would take about 30 days to even have made and powder-coated and ready to go. So I think what I'm looking for right now is some level of a spending threshold that we can move forward with in terms of continuing to get this truck outfitted and protected.
So what is exact on this whole laundry list?
Yes.
What is critical?
Well, can I ask a question?
Yep.
I'm sorry. What is a spy elder?
Where are you?
I'm on the state. Let's see, is it the second? No. Second page, second item. Can you tell me what that is?
That's the spray and truck liner.
Yeah, okay. Wait a minute. Is it spray and truck liner? Is that different from a normal bed liner?
Yeah, it's kind of like that, what's that called? Rhino liner? Have you ever seen that?
Okay, so this, there are two liners?
No, it would just be one liner. So rather than the plastic, what you normally see, it's a spray. They actually spray the material and it lasts longer.
Oh, really?
It's a much more durable set.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. I didn't understand that.
That's one of the ones I would recommend we do first.
Yeah.
Okay, yes, absolutely. The steps and that, I think, first.
Agreed.
I believe that the truck has fold-up seats in the back. So we can, let's experiment with small tools and parts and crates on the floor before we just decide, hey, we're going to go with these huge toolboxes on each side.
Right.
Let's just experiment. Let's get their experience. Hey, can we do it without them or do we need them?
Right. I wouldn't recommend moving forward with the high side boxes right this second, to your point. That's a $1,700 expense.
Correct. I'd like to defer that. I don't have any problem with the rack. I think that they'll probably find use for that.
They did make a good point about the safety light, too. I mean, this thing is oftentimes parked in precarious ways throughout the district.
Did I mention steps?
Yep.
Oh, good. Yeah, because that's like...
Uh-huh. It's tall. Some of our
guys... One of the beds is taller than one of our guys.
Yeah.
So we need to...
Well, and those are pretty minimal as well.
Yes.
You know, and if you're not putting on those high side boxes, things like that, it'll obviously reduce some of the labor involved. Keep in mind, the labor quote on this was, you know, for 8 hours at 95. So, you know, there's still going to be labor involved. It's not... These aren't... with labor prices. I would also, although the weather's getting a little bit better, I would certainly look at things like mats and stuff like that, protective flooring. Again, fairly nominal charges. I think if you look at the whole 5,800, you take out 1,700, you're now down to about $4,000, and that's just not moving forward with the high side box. I mean, what I'm hearing is...
prioritize based on
necessity
and experience.
Yeah, protect the vehicle, protect our staff, you know, make sure they can get in and out of the vehicle without hurting themselves, that kind of thing. Crossbar safety light thing, is this like an amber?
Correct.
Is that what that's?
That's okay. Exactly what it is.
Okay. So if they're out in the middle of a rainy night, taking a tree out of the road and stuff like that, they've got another means of...
They're parked awkwardly in an area just for access purpose or something like that. Yes, that puts it on there and basically creates another thing. The mesh that gets added to the rack, which you see right below the rack at $199, I fully agree with it. Basically, it's a steel meshing that goes across the back window, so it prevents, you know, things like tools and lumber from actually crashing through the window.
Okay. Yeah, I think under the box would be helpful. Yeah.
Can I ask some questions?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm assuming based on the discussion, because I can't tell from what's written here, the first item is some kind of a lumber rack?
Correct.
But you're getting a custom-made one, you aren't buying one off the shelf?
Well, they make them to fit the vehicle. It's a super long bed. This is the price they can quote it out on, yeah.
And what did we end up getting? A Ford F-150 with a
250?
250 long bed?
Yeah.
Okay, so I just, like I said, I'm having trouble with you. Some of you may understand what these things are.
It took me a while to read through it and make sure.
Okay, so the first one's a lumber rack. The second one is put mesh behind the window.
Correct.
Sense.
Correct.
The third, the next item is the safety light mounting bracket.
Correct.
How much is the safety light? Is that in here?
It's right below it.
That's the echo rear plate. Okay, that's that. Yeah.
So that's $700 for everything you need to put a safety light on.
But it includes the light.
Correct.
On the next page, seat covers front and back.
Looks like they haven't charged us for that. We do all this, they'll throw the seat covers in. That's what I'm getting out of this estimate.
Okay, because based on what John was saying, maybe you want to take the back seat out and use it for store for tools.
Well, the back seats bench flip up this way.
You can get twice as much space though if you remove the back seats.
Right.
And then the spray liner I gathered from the discussion.
Right.
And then floor mats. I just Sunday picked up a new F-150, and the floor mats are only going to cost me $82. But I've got the best ones for it.
Send me your guy.
I just went to the Nevada Ford, whatever. Call himself now.
Right. The primary thing that these guys do here isn't those types of accessories. It's all of the other hard-mounted things.
It's all...
the more hard-mounted, construction grade stuff.
Yeah.
It's got a super cabinet. I think that's why it's more expensive, because it's for front and back, I believe.
Just says front.
Oh, never mind. It holds 20 gallons of water, they told us.
The back rear floor liner is right underneath it.
Oh, okay.
We can keep those out to shop it around too.
Or or decide what you really need. Then on the next page, okay, that's the steps for your short guys, right?
For any guy,
for any
tall, it's tall.
It's tall.
Is yours four wheel drive?
No.
Okay, mine's four wheel drive. I can get it in out, but it's a step up.
Yeah.
Or down. So what are these items that you're looking to do now?
That's kind of the guidance that we were looking for from you, and I think what we were just moving forward with that. That's the park guy who's going to prioritize and go through this. Shane, that is just got back yesterday. I had them gather this. They said, give me everything that you think it needs, and then we'll prioritize it and go from there. So I think if you're going down the list, the two super important must-do things are the spray liner and the steps. We can stop there at the time being. However, I do think a rack is pretty important for the work they're going to be doing. Otherwise, they're going to have stuff hanging over the side as opposed to being properly secured up on top of a rack for longer ladders, any pieces of lumber they're getting, whatever they can. It's not the end of the world.
They're going to leave stuff up on the, I'm going to put it on the roof of the truck and start to wreck it too.
Correct.
was this anticipated when the truck was budgeted, or is this all extra?
Yeah, we knew there was going to be some costs in upfitting because we got a pretty bare bones. And we also, it came in at 27.9. I think we were originally looking at 30,000. So, and like Eric was saying, some of these are kind of must-haves. Some of them can happen next fiscal year.
Mm-hmm. And some of it could be applied towards the Measure A funding as part of this too. All of this would qualify. The purchase of the truck has already been approved through the county.
I know. I know my guys are real good saying, we need this new computer. It's only going to cost this. And then as soon as we get the computer, and we need the, this peripheral, this new program that wasn't in the discussion when we figured out how much we're going to spend on that computer. That's why I'm asking the question.
Uh-huh.
So do we know which ones we have?
I think we should take out the box, no matter what.
I'd be inclined to take out the toolboxes. And
toolboxes and floor mats?
At least the rear ones. It's the front ones that we're going to beat up.
The other items we're going to eventually need to make it a fully functional vehicle. It's just a matter of whether we want to pay for it now or...
You think the racks are going to be in it?
Yeah, because eventually, pretty soon, this is going to be our only vehicle to be doing everything with. So it makes a lot of, we do carry a lot of stuff, ladders, lumber, having the racks.
The toolboxes.
No, I think we can get away. They also, there's some cheaper divider systems you can put back there that I've seen. We can test it out and see. It could be something that, if we need them, we'll come back to the board and we can budget for it.
I mean, if they get to the point where they say, hey, we need a mobile warehouse, because we need parts all the time, we need a selection of little tools and stuff like that, and you want to keep them locked up, that's fine. If that gets past the point where they can't carry them inside and back,
And the majority of the time, when we've got projects, they're driving around in the smaller vehicles that do have the compartmentalized beds in them. Mm-hmm. They have to have the tools back there. For long, we don't travel that far to do repair where we go to Creekside, but
I understand.
I would say, will we be able to tow the CERT trailer?
No, we're not touching
that. You can tow the trailer on that thing.
So, may I make a motion?
Make a motion, please.
To approve the purchase of accessories that are necessary to protect the new truck and above all the health and safety of our staff. And it seems like the board agrees to leave out the aluminum high side box and the rear floor mats and go with everything else. That's my motion.
That was one heck of a motion. I'll second it.
Comments from the public?
Yes. I noticed most small landscaping crews, they will have a utility trailer. Mm-hmm. And on that utility trailer, they'll have water, they'll have special racks for lumber, they'll have toolboxes, and I actually think that's probably the way you want to go. Now, as far as a rolling warehouse, a lot of contractors also do use small trailers like the CERT trailer as a flexible warehouse that they can drive with them. I think that, and I know Shane's talked about a dump trailer, which is nice, but these trailers don't really cost that much, and I think obviously you need to do some things. The lumber rack is and the spray liner is important, but I think that really the most flexible configuration is going to be involved with the use of trailers. And plus, they're cheaper to insure.
We've got a trailer hitch, and we've got...
Yeah, it's all outfitted with heavy-duty trailer hitch.
Yeah.
Kill package.
Yep.
Very good.
Yeah, I was wondering if there was... How many bids there were for this?
I contacted at least four places The place that we ended up going with is the same place the county uses for all their purchasing, and he was by far the lowest.
Oh, okay, good. The other thing is, this is just a comment, and I know I'm talking apples and oranges, and it's very difficult to compare the two issues. However, we're talking right here, we're talking about a park truck along with accessories, and you're adding all these accessories, and it seems to be very easy to talk about and very easy to say, yeah, let's do it, when an hour or so ago, you were having all kinds of problems talking about the fireman's kitchen, which houses our firemen 24 hours a day, which also is a safety issue. They don't need beautiful remodeling kitchen. Well, $25,000 is cheap to remodel that teeny little kitchen. I remodeled my kitchen 40 years ago for, $20,000. I mean, that is cheap. So I'm just saying, it seems to be a little priority here where you are leaning more towards the park department as opposed to the fire department. And I think you should give the fire department more respect. Our men are there 24 hours a day. They have a horrific job sometimes to do. And I think they deserve just a little bit of empathy for what they do and what they need. Thanks.
Thank you. On that note, I guess.
You have a motion on
call. Yeah, you have a motion.
Motion and second.
Motion and second. Mm-hmm. Have a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Oh, rec and park maintenance activity report.
Yeah, just any questions?
Any questions? I'll just say two things. The pool's up and running for the Water Devils. We opened to the public on the 3rd, and summer camp registration has been going extremely well. I mentioned during the commission meeting that we were $200,000 in 30 minutes when we opened up to non-residents, so it was a good day. I think we're up around $600,000 right now. So camp registration is going well. That's all.
Great.
And thanks on the park side of things. Irv and I walked up the Pawnee Fire Road and checked out the area, which was nice of him to invite me along. And things don't look good up there. But
go.
But it stopped raining.
But it stopped raining. So
until next year.
I hope.
Okay. Anything else?
Thank you.
Yep. Any other questions?
You asking the public then?
Go for it.
Okay, well, this is actually a comment. I hate to have to make this comment each time, but the panhandle, the road is getting wider and wider. There's some tracks in the field. I don't know why this happens. Why does it continue to happen? I mean, seriously, it doesn't need to happen. And I think it needs to be corrected because that is recreation area. And if we take care of it right, it becomes an asset instead of an eyesore. I guess you did take out some barbecue things out of that area. There's only two in the picnic area. There's only two barbecues for like 8 picnic tables, and I wish I had known when you were going to do that.
We didn't take any.
You didn't take any out?
Nothing.
Well, there was, I remember there was, maybe not this year, but it's recently.
We haven't taken out any barbecues. We took out 2 picnic tables about 2 years ago.
Okay.
And that was the extent of it, unless something was stolen.
No, I don't think it was stolen. We took out the big fire pit, which was great, but and then we have a big barbecue. But it just seems like for that many picnic tables, you need more barbecues. But anyhow, I'm really more concerned about the lack of a management plan in that area, and it could look great, and we're going native plants. I mean, gosh, this is a big piece of real estate. Let's take care of it. That's it.
Thank you.
And I do have one little question. Along the panhandle, I've been walking it almost every day now. And even though the days are sunny, 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 there's big, gigantic puddles all along the panhandle. And then when the puddles half go away, then it's mud. Is there any way that you have extra dirt that you could kind of lay down on those puddle areas? Because it's really mucky.
So to answer your question, in years past, before my time, they used to put a number of different surfaces down, different types of rock, soil, sand. Mm-hmm. It is something I'm going to bring to the attention of the commission fairly soon about kind of to Stephen's point as far as, okay, we have four or five different types of materials on the panhandle. What's the proper material now? We do get complaints about dust in people whose backyards abut that area. So having one kind of uniform material going all the way down, whether it's dirt, rock, whatever it may be. So that'll be coming to the commission at some point in the near future.
Oh, good. Thanks.
And then the next, date of the next board commission meeting, March 28th.
And the inspection reports attached that the commission created, Shane Valentine spent a lot of time organizing it. As you can see, it has the items, the location, some basic cost estimates, whether the jobs have been completed or not. Moving forward, they want to keep this up to date so everything stays on the radar that hasn't been complete, and we'll add to it each year that we do facility inspections. And this obviously doesn't include everything that needs to be worked on, but it's what they want to prioritize from their inspections, via their inspections.
Can I ask you to contact Shane and make sure he's got no objections to be able to?
Yeah.
Thank you.
And we don't have to prove anything, though, right? Inspection?
No, just reference. New and other business? We're in LAFCO.
For your folks, hopefully you looked at them. Anybody have an order preference?
Go ahead.
As your LAFCO liaison, Craig Murray is one of the three that are looking to stay on this high-paying job. And he first is from this area in general. I think he was with Linda. He's on the Las Vegas Valley Senate District Board. So he's aware of our area. I know he's active on the Creek Committee that every now and again rears its head. And I know him from the various other activities. I think he would be it would be good to have him continue to represent the special district.
So sounds like rank number one.
I think so.
Okay.
Oh, you have to rank?
Yes. We have to rank them 1, 2, 3.
I think it was Todd Gates.
Todd Gates first. Has the multi-stage resume.
Yeah. And that guy's done everything.
That was,
he has too much experience.
Oh, overqualified.
Yes.
Well, he looked pretty sound to me, too. But anyway.
What do you think?
I have no perspective on this at all, and I'm taking Herb's direction.
I am too.
Yeah, so why don't we just say 1 for Craig and 2 for Todd,
and 3 for Todd.
Does that work?
No. How
does that sound? I move to rank the candidates as follows. Number 1, Craig, number 2, Todd, number 3, Lou.
I have a comment.
Please.
Playing gamesmanship with these kind of elections where you have the first choice and the second choice and the third choice, and all the information that we had from Todd Gates, to have a better chance of having Murray get elected, I would put Todd Gates' ranking as 3.
That's
and the other guy is 2.
Very clever.
You are enjoying this kind of gamesmanship, too.
You should be
be a politician.
The biggest smile on your face.
Yes, what is the play of the game?
I'm not sure I understand. But
I assume when they count these votes up,
comes in rank.
Right.
So on one, two, it's just like the same when they're all-star balloting and everything else.
And, or if you took it to a whole other level, or you'd like to revise your motion, Isabella?
I move to go with whatever Irv is saying. No, seriously.
But how can I vote for something I don't understand? You know?
I have no idea what you're doing.
We play Irv's game.
Flip a coin.
Okay. My strong preference is Craig number one in terms of second. So therefore, my motion is now Craig number one, Lou number two, Todd number three.
Do I hear a second?
Second. Just a question: is Craig Murray related to Cynthia Murray, our former supervisor?
He's related to the Bank of Marin family.
Okay. Then he's okay.
Okay.
Comments?
I will
call for a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
I have no idea.
Just go.
Okay. Doesn't make any sense to me. I really don't have that much of an opinion on anything.
Request for future meeting.
Excuse me. Did I hear an aye from Mr. Shea?
Pardon me?
Did I hear an aye from Mr.
Yes,
Shea?
You did.
Thank you. Didn't hear it.
Request for future meeting agenda items.
I have the cert kiosk. Let's not rush into that. We'll see what the cert committee says.
I do have
Jeff's input at the next meeting.
I do have something after the board gets through.
Okay. No requests?
I'm sorry if I'm mistaken in my memory, but has the employee handbook been done? I thought I saw it on a list last year.
It's in the hands of the union.
I'm sorry.
What? It has been in the hands of the union for the last
six months. But I thought that I had seen it on an agenda with your name on it.
Right, because Eric and I were working very intensely on it.
Okay.
And then after we completed it, we submitted it to the union. And
oh, so you guys have done work on it.
Yes, but we haven't seen it for half a year now.
That's okay. I mean, it's been 4 years already, so.
Wasn't when this was, when the edits occurred through Eric and Isabella's work and was vetted, I believe, by council, yes?
Yes.
Wasn't it written in such a manner where anything that conflicted with the MOU, the MOU, correct. I don't understand why we can't just publish this doggone thing. I really don't.
Because it's a part of the current negotiation.
And why didn't you guys split
it in half?
The MOU
supersedes, you know, anything that could be objectionable.
I hear you. We're playing nice and awaiting their comments so that they may feel has impact on wage, working conditions, or whatever the other W is.
I guess that's your answer, Linda.
Yeah.
Well, I was wondering why, I mean, this has been suggested many, many times. Why can't you just leave the fire portion separate from the regular employees? You got to put something.
I think that's what we intended to do, and it's not being seen that way, unfortunately. But yeah, I understand.
Okay.
Well, I guess that's it for requests. Recognitions and board member items of interest.
I'd like to thank Joe Ronco. Yes, we'll write a letter to him and thank you, Eric.